Yes, I heard that.
Join us for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening. Welcome to the April 27, 2015 Selectmen's Meeting. Tonight, we're going to start with the consent agenda.
We're acting in the public hearing?
We're starting with the consent agenda.
Okay, well, I will move the consent agenda, but I have two questions.
I'll second it.
On the tavern on L Street, is there a problem here with parking? I just wanted to check because I had a lot of the emails. Apparently, L Street is having significant problems, so I just thought I'd ask. And then the memorandum of understanding for the firefighters? Are
yes.
we not doing that separately?
We can if you want to remove it.
Well, I don't want to take it off forever.
There's been a motion. There's been a second. We've got a busy night.
Every night is a busy night. I just thought that's something that we have to review and sign. If I've read it, if you're comfortable, I have two small grammatical corrections.
It was suggested at the last meeting, if everybody read it, we could put it on the consent agenda
and
move it.
All right. And there are two small grammatical corrections that I'll just mention to Fred later. Okay.
Okay. All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you. Thank you all for coming this evening. We appreciate it. Tonight we're going to do it a little bit different than we did it last week, and we're going to ask that people try to speak and say what they have to say in 2 minutes. We're going to be taking into consideration what everyone says, and after you talk the first time, after everyone else has talked, you can speak again if you need to. So we're going to, again, limit it to 2 minutes, and when you'll get to follow up again the second time around if you'd like. And who would like to start out? Maybe our precinct people would like to talk and set some...
Okay, thank you.
Bob Ladd, Cutmore Avenue, Precinct Commissioner. I want to thank the Board of Selectmen for its courage in holding this meeting. But basically, this is an attempt in part by you folks, and we very much encourage it, to address some of the parking problems that seem to be becoming more acute in the district. This year, the areas of focus are the streets on the west side of Ashworth Avenue beyond the town parking lot and the island section. And hopefully going forward after this experiment, if you find things that work particularly well, it could be added to other sections of the beach at a further time. Again, thank you very much for holding it, and I would defer to the people who want to share their thoughts.
Thank you.
Bill. Yes, sir.
Why don't you put those chairs over there so the chief can sit?
Hi, Maureen Buckley, Precinct Commissioner. I just wanted to say to the board that tonight you'll be hearing some suggestions, and I do hope you'll take them into consideration. It isn't only about the fire and the police, with all due respect to Chief Wyador. It's not just about that. There's a lot of other things it's about, and I hope you'll keep an open mind and maybe come to some other decisions that might help us all. Okay,
thank
thanks.
You. Thank you for joining us at the table.
Thank you.
And who would like to start out?
We got some great emails.
Now you're all shy.
Yep.
Good. He's a brave man.
Good evening. My name is Andrew LaCourse. I live at 12 Atlantic Ave, unit number 5. I've been living there for 5 years. I moved my family here the day after my child was born. She's over there, the cute little one with the blonde brown hair and her beautiful mother. I understand Hampton's very busy place. Be quiet. There are a couple issues that have to be addressed, though. Blocking of driveways. It happens. I can't get out. I work for a living, unfortunately. I wish I did not. I wish I was independent and wealthy. And I know it's focused primarily on parking, but there are other issues like fireworks shooting over buildings. If the fire chief was here, he would attest to fact, we had a fire at the end of Atlantic Ave, April 21st last year, and if the parking was as congested as it is in the summertime, there would have been, we lost, I think one unit was a total loss, and one other was damaged perhaps. It would have been a lot worse if the parking was as congested as it is in the summertime. My mother, who since passed, when she came down to visit in the prior 3 years, she's been deceased 2 years, she had to walk on the street because the sidewalks are so narrow, and then everyone parks in front of 12 Atlantic Ave. There's enough spot for one legitimate legal parking spot, but they squeeze two in. So, and then the cars are parked about an inch from each other, which causes them to block part of where I park my car. You know, the police do what they can. I know people are coming to vacation. The police don't want to, you know, give everyone a hard time, and they've been respectful in their response to my concerns. And I hope the board takes some serious consideration into making one side of the street a fire lane. It's a real public safety concern. I know something about firefighting. My father was the fire chief in Lowell. I worked as an assistant district attorney in Middlesex County in Massachusetts for a number of years, and I'm a lawyer for 15 years now. So I know something about when parking spots are obstructed, if we have a heart attack or an elderly person, and I know a gentleman said at the other meeting, we don't know, there hasn't been a problem like that. But let's not wait until we have that problem to make a pointed response. And that doesn't mean, say, you know, go full bore and hurt the businesses, because you have to balance residences' interests with businesses. I know in the island section, most of the businesses have some parking. And most of their traffic is the people who park and then walk by, not necessarily people pulling up and parking. So I don't think those businesses are as dramatically affected by the lack of parking. And I would just thank the board for their consideration in taking this matter
thank
up.
You thank for you for your comments.
I have a quick question for that
okay,
gentleman,
gonna,
if I may.
We're going to be saving the questions to the end.
Well, while he's here, I'd like
okay,
to ask him a quick
after
question.
After this, we're going to be saving them to the end.
On the fireworks, sir, was this the big fireworks at the beach or fireworks that people are shooting off in
oh,
the
no,
neighborhood?
Oh, no, we enjoy the public yeah. display on Wednesday nights.
These are people
the
shooting
it's
off.
Really shooting over the buildings and having stuff landing on the buildings.
Personal fireworks,
yes,
sir.
Yes.
Okay, good. Thank you.
I did leave out one thing, which is the public urination and public drinking, which
thank you.
Yes.
Okay. I can see someone having a beer. I can look the other way on that.
Thank
but,
you.
But urinating on my yard, on my car.
Thank you. We're not going to be entertaining questions, just so that you know. Okay, who would like to be next?
I might as well get this off my chest. How does that sound?
Good evening, everybody. My name is Eileen DeBoole, and I live on Harris Ave. I want to thank you all again quickly for having us here. It's good to be able to get some ideas and some gripes off our chest. Tonight I'm speaking in behalf of the majority of the property owners on Harris Ave. I'm speaking specifically in behalf of numbers 6, 12, 14, 18, 23, 21, 15, 13, and 11. I'm going to be suggesting something to you that all of these property owners have very happily and willingly agreed to do. But first, I do want to address the increased speeding. As you come in a southerly direction from Brown Avenue, the majority of the streets on the west of Ashworth are dead end. They just go into the water. However, when you hit Fellows, you go down Fellows, shoot over Harris, and go back up Dustin. Thus, I call Harris Ave the Ashworth Ave bypass. It's in order to avoid 20 or 25 cars that are sitting there in traffic. So, honestly, I really think something has to be done with it, and I put it in your hands to evaluate it, police and fire. We have a lot of little children, and every night you sit out in the front and you just go, somebody's going to get hit. You can hear them coming. About 3 years ago, and now I'm going to get to my main request from you. About 3 years ago, we noticed the environment of a so-called residential neighborhood take a major downward trend. We were so concerned about the parking, the noise, the blocking of our walkways. We had a 91-year-old woman who could not get out in her wheelchair because the wait staff from Bernie's Bar and Grill refused to move their cars. We became the private parking lot for Bernie's Bar and Grill, wait staff and customers. it just got to the point where we really couldn't take it any longer, and there was some discussion at a precinct meeting whereby Chuck Rage asked if some of us would like to go to the meeting that was going to be held on Seabrook Beach relative to parking issues. And three of us went, myself, Maureen Buckley, and Bob Ladd. We went to every meeting. But we soon learned that they obviously have their differences as we do, and a lot of it had to do with you're laughing, Mr. Roche, with with a lot of stickers, multicolored stickers, placards, and duplicated placards, and basically it was a supply and demand. Too many tickets, too many stickers, and not enough spaces. So we were happy we went, but we had to get back to Hampton. So as we come back, we differ greatly from them, but we still have a huge problem. We don't sleep at night because the wait staff comes home at 3:30 in the morning. Many of us work. The majority of us are owner-occupied on that street. So this has become really discouraging as we spend a lot of money on our properties. We pay a lot of tax. So I asked a lot of neighbors if they would be willing to do the following thing, to ask the town if they would be willing to enter into a temporary trial where the residents of Harris Ave only for 1 year, from May till September, could have permit parking only, not resident parking, but permit, that the two signs be posted at each end of the street, and that each property owner who wished to partake in this could go to the town hall and obtain a placard that would list their address. It's one placard per property owner only. That way, if your cousin came up and you wanted to stick the placard in the dashboard of their car, you wouldn't be trying to take something off of your car or all that sort of thing. I feel that this temporary trial would be worthwhile for a year. Get together afterwards and evaluate exactly where we're going. As I see this growth and development now headed in a southerly direction down Ocean Boulevard, I'm worried. This is a community and not one big business, and there should be room for all of us to live with some measure of comfort. We're all aware it's busy here. We all came probably because it was busy and we loved it. But it's time to be fair to all. And we do pay the taxes, and quite frankly, we are the voters. Most of the business people don't live on Hampton Beach, and they don't live in Hampton either. And
you're going to be able to talk again, Eileen. So
well, one more point, and then I'll go. You got my message about the permit. We need to investigate the state park. I'm charging the town, the state, the village district, the beach commission, and a representative of the business community to investigate that jewel that's a gift to us in the mouth, and everybody's walking away from empty-handed.
And
we need it.
You will get to speak
thank
again.
You.
Okay, thank
okay.
you.
Thanks.
Okay, who would like to come next?
Hey, good evening. My name is Steve Light. I live in Riverview Terrace. That almost sounds like deja vu from back when we were here in 2012 when we had the same complaints about Riverview Terrace and Johnson and Wally's and the parking and mm-hmm. all the issues. And for a while we met with the commissioner, Commissioner Sullivan, and we also met with Dan. And a lot of it had been resolved for that period of time. Wally's was going to take care of a lot of the issues. Some of them were taken care of, but there's a lot that haven't been taken care of as far as the lighting, the trash, the delineated spaces at the Wally's parking lot. When it rains, all the trash just flows out onto either Johnson or Riverview and basically flows into my driveway. The parking, it causes parking issues. There's no patrols that go down and recall about some of the cars that are blocking, and really no one comes down to take care of the issues down there. There were some really good patrols back in 2012 that used to go around the back Riverview, go down Johnson, patrol the parking lot, patrol the streets, and we haven't seen any patrols since then. It was really quiet down there last year as far as no patrols. If you take a ride over there now, you're going to see where folks have just been lighting their tires up in the back of the parking lot. There's 30-foot of rubber mark And that happens just at closing. Now, the officers park out front of Wally's, but nobody goes in the back of Wally's. So, again, there's still a lot of issues there. You know, you look back and what Al was able to do. He was able to remodel Wally's two or three times. He was able to put up Bernie's over a course of 6 months. He was able to open the GOAT. But we can't get one parking lot finished. You know, I just don't understand that. It's been over that two-year period where that should have been done in August of 2014, and it still hasn't been completed. So I think by putting the delineated spots in place, putting trash can receptacles, putting the lighting exactly where it should be, take those godly poles down and stick 40 feet up into the air, and it's an eyesore. You know, the other issues are just... you know, the flooding, the water on Riverview Terrace, you know, the normal issues we've had with the folks that come down there. But we don't get any help. We haven't got any help down there. So we're at the point where just, like, my wife and I have been talking. We just want to rent it out. I mean, if everybody's coming in from Lawrence and nobody's patrolling, might as well just join a crowd and rent our place out to the folks from Lawrence. And go back down south where we had a good time last summer, or
thank you.
Last fall.
Thank you for your comments. And you'll be able to follow up if you can.
All right. Like.
Mr. Chairman, if I could, I feel something's got to be addressed here.
Okay.
Whether somebody's from Lawrence or not, there's a lot of us that come from Merrimack Valley originally, and I really can't sit idly by here and listen to these type of comments being made without responding. Also, the lack of nobody's there. Mr. Light, I'm sure you've noticed the officers that have been at the top of your street for the last three weekends.
On the front row, yeah.
Yeah, no, they've gone out back, because I can show you the arrest reports that actually show that the information you gave here is inaccurate at best. Making accusations the way you do at each of these meetings is just inappropriate. Let's talk about the facts so we can deal with the facts. And whether somebody's from Lawrence or not, really, I got to tell you, that really is inappropriate. Thank you.
Thank you. And who would like to speak next? Please join us at the podium.
Hello, my name is Al Fleury. I own Wally's and Bernie's, and I live in Hampton. I just don't want to think anything like that with the parking lots being ignored. I've been meeting with Kevin for 2 years. They just, on Tuesday, cut the electrical poles that I have nothing to do with. That's Unitil and the townspeople thing. That Jamie Stephan, when he was with us, I couldn't progress any further with my project until, like, we had to do test pits and drainage and lighting, and that's all been approved. We went through lighting engineers, drainage people, all that stuff. Now that the town is caught up and they've cut those poles down, I met with Kevin the other day, a week or two ago, Kevin Schultz, and I met with a new town planner, and I'm eager to go forward and stripe the lines and do the whole thing as well. So we're moving forward with that, signage, the whole deal. And I'll say the same. The police are always scooting around the parking lot, and I mean, they're on. I see them going through there all the time. That's it.
Thank you. And who would like to speak next? Please join us at the podium.
My name is Larry Stone. I live at 14 Harris Ave. My complaint is, no disrespect to the police or the fire. I've been in the ambulance business for 45 years. My beef is with, why isn't the ambulance kept on the beach? Why? I need an explanation. I went through this 3 or 4 years ago. And that's, I just don't want to repeat myself like Eileen did, because we all have the same problem. That's a real problem. That's right. I think she did a great job, and I had the same problem. You know, when I owned two houses on Harris Ave, and we pay a lot of taxes. And that's why I want to know why the ambulance isn't kept on the beach. What is the beach end here, and the ambulances all stay uptown, so that's 5 or 6 minutes more to get to the people that live on the beach.
Okay. Chief, why don't you respond to that?
As far as the ambulance issues, that's really not something I am.
So you don't, I mean, is it never at the beach, I don't think that's the case, is it?
You'd have to speak to Chief A on it. I know
the fire chief isn't here. I'm sorry.
I went through this 2 years ago. And
we will look into it. It will be
no
one of our...
No disrespect to you, but no, that's the
I
same
know.
Thing I got brushed
I was here
off.
2 years ago. Yeah.
But, you know, I've been in the business for a long time. I'd like to know why. Does that mean the town says those people are better off than us
well,
down
that's
here?
That's not happening. But we will take it into consideration, and we will get an answer for you, and it will be repeated out.
Okay.
Yeah.
That'll be fine.
But I have
Thanks.
A feeling that the ambulance isn't always not there, as far as I know.
Well,
take a seat, okay. Rita.
Hi, my name is Cindy Parnagian, and I own a house on Concord Street at the end on the ocean, and my complaint is about trash. So I don't know if we're talking
He's
trash.
Yes, we are.
Okay, so the end of Concord Street, there is one public trash barrel on as you're going down towards the ocean on the left-hand side. Within a day, it's overflowing, and it only gets picked up Monday, Wednesdays, Fridays? No? Then it's not enough, mm-hmm. because there should be at least 2 to 3 to handle the amount of people that come out on the beach.
You're talking about the, please no talking in the room.
The public trash barrels.
Yes, so the ones that are along.
At the end of the walkway?
Yeah, those are picked up generally twice a day. They're supposed to be, if they're full.
Then the people that live there, if they know that it's being picked up that much?
They pick up every morning between 6 and 7 o'clock off the beach. All those barrels are picked up every single day.
And then at the end of the day, the state picks them up if they are full. That is what we're... Well, along Ocean Boulevard, that's what's supposed to be happening.
Then but maybe more barrels could be
We will inquire. We're listening to everything that you have to say here, and we're taking all this in consideration. Do you have, what about the your trash at your home?
Well, that gets picked up, but that the people coming off the beaches are using our barrels.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Okay, well, we'll take, you know, we appreciate your comments. Thank you very much. And who else would like to speak? There's a big room here. Please join us.
Hi, Tim and Debbie Vasha. We have a cottage on Hobson Ave. And the kids from either Mama Leone's or
Funorama.
Come and park on our street, and I know one of my neighbors last year had asked them to move because he was right at the bottom of his front stairs, and the boy started yelling at him and said, "This isn't, you know, it's public parking. I know I can park here," and parked right at the bottom of his stairs. And I had come to town hall last year or the year before, and we couldn't get. They park right across the street from each other, and the trash truck couldn't get down. So we went quite a while without getting trash picked up, and we were going to be leaving, and our renters were going to be coming in. So we just like to see, and also when they come at the end of the day, they do dump their trash right outside their cars and take off. So. You know, I'd like to have my trash picked up. I don't want to have to bring it back in and, you know, not have it picked up week after week because the...
So are there days when your trash doesn't get picked up?
Yes.
And do you call the DPW? Yeah.
They said that they couldn't get down. They said they already called it in. There was too many cars. They couldn't get through the cars on the street.
So they just
and
skip it.
So they don't come to pick up our trash. And this wasn't one day. This was... I want to say a Monday, Wednesday, and a Friday. And, you know, I just...
What street is this again?
Hobson.
Hobson.
Okay, are you aware of this, Mr. Welch?
He is now.
Well, I am now, but we do have parking problems down there because they park on both sides of the street.
Yeah, right.
And it's too narrow for a cruiser to get through it sometimes. It's also too narrow for our trash truck to get through.
Right.
So these are the type of things that we're taking in. You know, we're making notes here, and we're taking into consideration, and the... It sounds to me like that would be a life safety issue.
Right.
Those are the issues that we're most concerned with. So
right.
thank you
there's,
for coming
there's
and
no way,
making the comments. It's hard with the people that are people working at the beach because everybody's entitled to park there if there are empty spots.
Right, and isn't there anything that they could do so that, like the woman over here said, isn't there any way that they could make a parking? You know, I understand the kids are young. They don't have the money to pay.
40 years ago, when I was young, it was a problem then, and it's one of those things that isn't very easily solved.
If they could just make a parking area for the people that are, you know, working.
That's probably not going to happen, but we're going to take into consideration these other things where we can make it a little bit better on your street. Thank you. Thank you for your.
Halfway down the street, there's no parking on either side, and then.
Those are the streets that we're most, you know, we're concerned with everything, but these are the type of comments that we want to hear. Life and safety is a big,
there's no
very
way
big thing.
To get down right.
So we appreciate your comments. Who would like to speak next?
Good evening. Kathy Keir, 7 Boston Ave. Last week, Mr. Chairman, you asked if over the past 10 years things are getting worse. First, we made all the leaded streets one-side parking. Those cars are going somewhere else. Now we're building condos, overspilling with one parking space, overspilling. Those cars are going somewhere else. And this is like the Field of Dreams. Build it and they will come. Well, the state built it and now they're coming. So here we are, stuck with all this no parking for these vehicles that are coming. And as far as Boston, I'm talking for Boston Ave, and I'm thankful that our streets are wide on Boston Ave. And Officer Chief Sullivan, Chief Sawyer said that some streets don't need one-side parking. I hope we don't get that at the island, because that would just more cars. I'm worried about Peace Street. The building going up on P Street, where are those cars going to go? I don't think that we should have people that come to the beach for the day parking on the side streets. I think they should be paying tolls in order to park. The things that happen on Boston Ave, the issues we have, are urinating on the properties. I kick them off. I take care of my neighbors' properties. They're not following the winter parking ban. There are two parking signs at the bottom of Boston Ave that says no parking between signs. People are parking there all year long. And in the summer, that's where the handicapped ramp is put, where those signs are. So the handicapped's coming down, and they can't get there because there's so many cars parked there. Noise till 3 or 4 in the morning. I had to call Mr. Bean last year for a problem like that. Vans come on the street and they park and they're sleeping there for the night. So I call the police. I have started to call the police for everything. I used to not do that, but I call the police department. I tell them every time there's an ordinance broken, I call. I'm hoping with Chief Sawyer that things will improve because he's a very nice man.
I have to say that.
He's a very nice guy. And
if you want to wind up, we will have another chance to talk.
Well, I'm going to, I'll have to talk some more because I got other things
okay,
I like to say.
Okay, thank you. Who
would
like
Sawyer
to speak?
Pay you?
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Stop dating something.
Okay, Mary Louise.
Oops.
Jesus.
Hi, my name is Bill Cross. I live on Hobson Avenue. And I've been involved with the parking on that street, as we probably all know, for a lot of years.
Yeah.
I'm going to say something that you haven't heard tonight, but the town has a mechanism to resolve these problems, and I'm personally one of the beneficiaries of that mechanism. Mainly get the people together, publish a very detailed piece of paper indicating what you want to do, and if it's possible. The police have been very responsive to our area on Hobson Avenue. One thing that I would caution anybody that's even suggesting the idea of putting residential parking in front of their property so that the streets aren't occupied is that you have to understand that that's residents of the town of Hampton. That means anybody can open up, anybody can use those parking spaces. We are fortunate on Hobson that we have a no parking zone that starts at 257 feet from Ashworth Avenue and runs to what we used to call the sewer easement. And we've had that now for, I'm going to guess, 15 years. And it's worked out very well for us people that live on the easterly end of Hobson Avenue after the hotel. I share the concerns of the people that live on from the sewer easement down to the end with the parking, especially late at night when the businesses get out and the help comes down and in returns, you know, the beach help comes down and returns to their vehicles on Hobson. And because that is the closest street to basically the business area of the town. Manchester Street next, and then Keith, and they share the same problems. But we had made provisions for all the people that live at the very end of Hobson Avenue to join us, that were in the middle section of Hobson Avenue, on a petition to make the street no parking. And apparently there was no issue at that time for them. I do share their concerns. I see the problems. 1 o'clock in the morning after the bars closed, the noise, the partying, the public urination on people's steps I have seen. Okay? And that Hampton Beach is a very busy place after 1 o'clock in the morning. We have now 5 or 6 full-time residents that live on the beach. I live on Hobson Avenue. I remember when I was the first person that lived there year-round. But I want to commend the police department, and I want to just say that the town has been good to us people that organized the effort to make Hobson Avenue no parking, and I would volunteer my help with anybody that needs any issues
Thank
on that.
You. Thank you. I can you. Remember you helping and doing that. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Good evening.
Hi, Helena Barthel, 33 Dover Avenue. Two things quickly. We do, I don't know whether it's the town or the state, puts out the trash can at the end of Dover Avenue for people as they come off the beach. And we're very appreciative of that, and we'd like it to start really now or sooner because people get spring fever and they will just leave their trash if there's no can there. It is picked up every day in the summer, but while the ones on Ocean Boulevard may be picked up at night by the state, it might be nice if they could come down to the end of the road and pick up the ones by the beach, because at the end of the day they are overflowing. It would be more sanitary.
And is that the state beach that's there?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. And the other thing is, speaking of the state beach, there's a machine that comes through and grooms the sand every night. I don't know the name of it. We refer to it as the Sanboni. And it seems to... It seems to clean and do a beautiful job on the entire beach, the whole width from jetty to jetty, except in front of the four houses between Dover and Concord. I've even approached the person who's operating it at night. I've run up to him and say, "Why aren't you? You know, why are you taking this detour?" And they go, "We're told not to come here."
They can't.
And I don't know why.
It's because there is a protected area in there for the piping plovers. So they've been told just not even to go
well,
up.
Well, that's the dune, but they're but in they front were, of people's homes, in front of those four houses, just four houses on the whole beach, and we don't get it raked.
That's the reason you can bring that. The state parks folks, you could raise that issue with them, but maybe we could mark it somehow so they could clearly see it just at night. When they're up there and there's people around and they're just trying to stay away from that protection area is what they're trying to accomplish.
Well, thank you.
Thank you very much for speaking. Would you like to join us at the podium? You look like you're ready to speak.
Yes.
Thank you.
Hi, my name's Alexandra Carew and I'm 11 Concord, I'm 11 Atlantic Avenue. And we built the cottage 2 years ago. And last year, I noticed we had a lot of snow on our side of the street, especially on my property. The property was neglected for a few years before we bought it. So it was a lot of trash, and it was, I came with the kids, and we clean up, and we try to make it maintain and look good and everything. So I said, okay, this year we're going to do something to my, I said to my husband, we put the orange fence. We went to spend the money, put the orange fence so no one would plow across the street, the snow to us. And it's a hazard for, in case emergency, something happens at my house and the fire truck cannot, you know, come and get, you know, get the water to it, you know, it's a big issue. This year, after, I don't remember the first or second snowstorm, I drove to check on my cottage. What I see, I can't even see my cottage. It's a big pile of snow. And then I see on the other side, it's hardly any snow. And so I really, my neighbor was plowing. I really got upset with him. He even, you know, didn't do it because I was upset with everybody who did it. So he was the first one, and he get it all. So, and I want to apologize to him. But a couple weeks later, after that, I came back to the beach, and the town did such a nice job removing all the snow because it was just such a narrow street. No one could, you know, get back and forth. But that pile of that snow, and plus my neighbor plowed the driveway so in case, you know, emergency or something, someone, the fire department could come. But that's an issue because people on the other side, it's some condominiums, and they don't have place to park, park or put the snow. And they just piling up on my site. It's 11 Atlantic Avenue.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
We appreciate it. You came down here tonight? Thank you. Who would like to speak? Please join us at the podium.
Hi, my name is Mike Malloy. I live at 18 Harris Ave. Same thing. I mean, everybody's pretty much said what I need to say, but I'll just add a couple things, I guess. We don't have any sidewalks on Harris Ave, so when somebody parks in front of your house, we don't have that 2-3 foot buffer zone like you would if you had a sidewalk. So when they park in front of your walkway, it's literally in front of your walkway. And as I believe Eileen mentioned, we've got elderly, we've got some people on the street with double knee replacements. These people can't be stepping up 2 feet onto their wall and having to walk around these cars. They shouldn't have to. They can't. So that's a big issue. The trash, obviously, yep, that's an issue. You know, people come for the day, enjoy Hampton Beach for 8-10 hours, and instead of feeding money into a meter, all we're left with is their trash. Yep. Their bottles that they've left, emptying out their ashtrays, whatnot. We get a lot of overflow parking from other neighborhoods where people have rented, you know, cottages for $2,000-$3,000 a week. But because they've got no parking, no off-street parking, we'll go down to Harris Ave, park there. Or go over to Dover Ave, park there. I know they've got the issues over there as well. My parents live on Dover Ave. So when you rent a unit, you should be parking close to that unit, as close as possible. You shouldn't be sending, you know, if these people come up and they're putting 15 people into a unit that probably, I know each unit, they tell you how many people are supposed to be occupying that house for the week. And you know people are overflowing these houses. So they're showing up with 4 or 5 cars when they should probably only have 1 or 2. That's, I think, a big, big problem.
I think you're right. That's
absolutely. It's, you know, it happens all the time. More often than not, when we get people parking down Harris Ave, you know, why are you parking here? Well, I was told to come down here and that there's plenty of parking here. Well, yeah, there is for us. We're talking about, and I know everyone pretty much got together on Harris Ave, so I won't speak for any other neighborhood, but we're talking, just to be clear, permit parking, not resident parking. There's definitely a difference. You know, we're not asking that everybody in Hampton, which I would rather see people from Hampton come and park as opposed to maybe the day trippers because they might be a little bit more respectful. But we are definitely talking permit parking, not resident parking, being the difference. And we do get an overflow of the business parking down our way, and you try to approach them, and they are very unapproachable. They think they're above it. They make snide comments to you. Well, I can park here, and if you have a problem with it, call the police. You know, they're not easy to talk to people. And just the biggest thing, I've got 2 kids, and our street is riddled with kids. I don't think there's a street on Hampton that has more kids. On a daily basis, there's 15, 20 kids out in front of my house playing. And you can't tell me that when you're coming down that street, if there's no cars in the street, I can stand at the end of Fellows Ave, and I could probably see my kids playing in the street. You put a line of cars there, you're not going to see those kids. And my kids are great. They look both ways 99% of the time. 1%. That one time they don't look and they come from behind a car, that's when it's going to happen. So that's the big safety issue for me and my kids. You know, they're kids. And when I grew up, you play in the street, you play street hockey, you play basketball. Kids play in the street.
Yeah, they're not supposed to, though.
They're not supposed to.
Let's make that clear.
But, you know, let's make that clear. And I've had that discussion with multiple people.
That gets talked about a lot here in Hampton.
I'm sure it does.
Thank you.
But I think if you go anywhere and...
Thank you very much. You'll be able to speak again if you'd like. Thank you.
Thank you.
Who else would like to speak? Please join us.
Good evening. I'm Richard Dobson on Manchester Street, and we have a few parking issues.
Which street did you say?
Manchester.
Oh, Manchester.
Manchester, yes. At one time, several years ago, there was signage on the streets, and they just seemed to have gone their way. There was no parking either side, and hopefully that would help the problem. I would like to see that reinstituted, get the signage back up, and maybe something with strictly enforced on it, because it's violated all the time. It's just what people do. The other situation.
How many years ago was that when it was posted no parking?
Oh, probably 5-6 years ago.
Are you familiar with that?
And well before.
It was a private road at that time.
Yeah. No, it was never a private road. It was deemed a private road for a short time, but that was another. And then it was deemed back a public street. That was an issue probably 5-6 years ago. Possibly that's when the signs disappeared. They were taken down by DPW, I don't know. But the no parking either side signs were up for 10-15 years. But now they disappeared. Okay. So it would be nice to have those reinstalled with maybe some stronger language on it, strictly enforced. I don't think that really makes a lot of difference to a lot of people, but that's in your lap. The other issue is on the corner street, there's a hotel there, and they have limited parking, and they park their tenants right on the corner. It makes the corner blind. It makes it narrow. Coming out of the street, if there's someone trying to enter, now someone's got to challenge each other. We have to fight the space, so on and so forth. And it makes it terribly blind going both directions. I'd like to see that rectified. I don't know if that constitutes a stern letter to the owner of the building saying that you're parking your cars the way you do presents a hazard, which it does. And the other issue is the street itself. It's in terrible, terrible disrepair. Mm-hmm. Over the years, several streets west on the west side of Ashworth have been repaved, and they did a great job. There's all kinds of holes in them. There's no sidewalks there, so we all walk in the street. And there's just holes there just waiting to break ankles, twist ankles. You know, it'd be nice if a big ticket item, I know, to have that repaved or repaired, or at least get that in process.
Thank you. We appreciate your comments.
Thank you
very much. Who would like to join us? There's a lot of people here. Now's your time.
How you doing? I'm Tom McGuirk. I live at 95 Ocean Boulevard. Actually, I have a couple of the opposite concerns that the last speaker had. On Auburn Ave, where I live during the summertime, we had it repaved last year. And so it's beautiful. And maybe 2-3 years previously, I had each one of our properties pinned. So that way we knew exactly where our property line ended. We put a stripe down the street. So that way we knew where the street was, where our property was. And, you know, every year and it's kind of comical, there's no parking on Auburn Ave unless you own the property because it's only 14 foot wide. But every year somebody in my family gets a ticket in our yard, which is kind of comical. I don't mind it. We just bring it down and say, can you not ticket us in our yard? And they take care of it. But my problem is I spent thousands of dollars on pens that are gone. And I'd like my pens back. You know, it's nice that you gave me a street, but I would like to know where my property is. You know, because that costs a lot of money. We have 124 Ashworth, 1 Auburn, 14 Auburn, 2 Auburn Ave Extension, 30 Perkins Ave. The only property that we didn't have the pins taken up was on Mooring Drive. But all of those other properties, we like to know exactly where our property is, and that's why we had the properties pinned.
Surveying pins?
Surveying pins. You know, I called up, and I was given a Mickey Mouse answer that was my problem. It's not my problem. You know, it's like, it's not. You know, somebody came down, they had a little magnet. Here's the pin. Great, you found one out of a dozen. Can you find the rest of them for me? Because I'd like to mark my property so that way I can park. Yeah. And that way people won't park in front. They can't park in front of the house. It's too narrow of a street. But I'd like to park on my own land. So that's a little bit different than everybody else's complaint. But, you know, that did cost me money. And, you know, I don't have enough money to just throw away.
Thank you. Who else would like to speak? No one else wants to speak? Okay.
Yeah. Ed McDonald, 21 and 25 Epping Ave. Been on the beach for many years. My folks first bought their place in 53, right on Boston Avenue. I've been on Epping Ave for 50 years, 46 years in my own place. And down the island section, the parking hasn't really changed. The number of units down in the island section are probably the same now as they've been for 40 or 50 years. The parking hasn't changed considerably. People can park on a on a public street. They should be allowed to park on a public street without being intimidated by owners or anyone else. I have plenty of parking at my properties for the places that I rent. The property at 21, I can fit 10 cars in for 3 units, so I'm golden on that. 25, I can put at least 9 if I had to for two rentals, so I'm all set. But the people that are coming to the beach to rent, the island section has had as many units now as I can remember 70 years ago. You know, maybe the Atlantic apartments at the end of Atlantic Avenue added more. But there's like the one behind the motel right in Concord Avenue. They took down one, put up 3. But this year they took 3 down on Epping and put up 1. So I mean, there's really no increase or decrease down there. With regard to the litter, I used to make a lot of money when I was a kid walking the beach picking up penny bottles and nickel bottles and bringing them to the White Rock for the deposits. And Morris didn't like them if they didn't have all the sand off, or if you didn't buy them there, he'd be tough on you. But why did they remove all of the trash barrels on the beach? They call it carry in, carry out. Carry out to the boardwalk. Why not put them back out on the beach where they were, you know, 40, 50 years ago, and allow people to use those trash barrels and have them picked up? We just don't have enough trash barrels at the beach. If you go up on the boardwalk on a weekend, people are trying to do the right thing, except there's not enough provided for them. I mean, you get 2 barrels at the entrance to those, maybe 3 or 4 at some of the major, but you need more trash barrels. You need them more, picked up more often. And then I just noticed this year, I don't know whether this year or the last few years, at the end of the, like in the island section, Boston, Concord, Dover, that there's been trash barrels. I don't know who services that. Is that the town or the state? Because that's the town beach in front of, all the way from
the town takes
Bradford down to Epping.
So thank you for your comments, and you will get to speak again if you'd like. Thank you. Who would like to speak, particularly somebody that has something that hasn't been said? And feel free to say what's been said. Please join us. There's a lot of people here. Okay, then no one wants to speak for the first time?
Oh. Hi, my name is Ode Pignon, live on 15 Tuttle Ave. I got a few things to say. I've been working on the beach for a long time. I worked for your father, Richie. There was a parking issue back then. It's a parking issue now. Many days I drove down, worked for your father, double parked, with hazards lights on, and being in the kitchen, waiting for somebody to move so I can legally park. It's not going to change. Matter of fact, we have less parking now than back then. You do not want to do it resident parking only. That would be the wrong approach. Example, my neighbor at the on the right side, yes, they own the house. But they couldn't even park in the front of their own house if it's resident parking only because they don't live here. They're property owners, not residents. So I think you guys got to watch out. That's a very fine line, what you want to do. We all need the parking. We all have problems parking, trash, unruly people who come down here. Yeah. Yes. But it's a matter of lack of enforcement on some of the things. But you're not going to call the police because somebody threw a dirty diaper there. Or what else they do? Leave the empty beer cans behind when they go back in their cars. I think resident parking would be the wrong approach. It's only my own personal opinion. Yes, they piss me off sometimes myself. It's the wrong approach. Okay. You got to look at the whole picture, not just what's going to happen in front of your own house.
Uda, do you have any problems at your business?
No.
That you'd like to bring up here?
No. They bang on the door at 3 o'clock in the morning and mumble, blah, 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 blah. Can you open up? And it's now 5 o'clock. I have no problems.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much. Mr. Rage, did you want to join us?
I was watching from in here. There's no room here. Chuck Rage, 121 Ocean Boulevard, Precinct Commissioner. I think that a lot of the parking issues are just because of a lack of convenient parking. And I think a lot of the things that we need to do is work with the state where they close their lot early, that people can't park in the state parking lot because they have to be out by, I believe it's 8 o'clock.
8 o'clock.
So, and I've talked to Mike Hausman about that, of having it later there, because I think if people were, it would open up more parking for people in the restaurants and shopping in the area where they wouldn't be having to look on the side streets in the residential area. So I really think you should really work with them. The new lot that the Village District is trying to put together should help a little bit, but we need to have better signage. Island Path is always empty at night, unless it's a fireworks night that we put on, and that brings all the people down to Island Path. Church Street, we could do a little more with resident parking. Maybe at certain hours where it wouldn't affect the income for the town. So I'd like to see everybody trying to work together, the state, the town, and the Village District. Thank you.
Thank you. Other, Brian?
Brian Lapham, 27 High Street. Thank you, Chief. I would just like to say, just to remark on what Chuck just spoke about, if we can get between the new parking lot at the beach, if we can get something, you know, maybe at a discount, but at least it's money coming into the town, that we can get set up something where these businesses can get and, you know, secure some parking spots, that may alleviate some of it. The rest of it, it's going to happen because you're allowed to park there unless the rules are changed. But if we can work with the rest of the town, and Island Path, perfect example, where we can maybe lease some of these spots and still get some revenue out of it. Okay, maybe we won't charge them the same price. Maybe we can help. Thank you.
Thank you. Somebody else that would like to speak?
Hello, my name is Alicia Preston. I live at 25 Tuttle, and I just wanted to address the concept of permit or resident parking. I am completely opposed to the idea. I do not own the rights to the road in front of my house. It is a great convenience for me, so I don't have to do the car shuffle. But government is not in the business of personally being required to provide me a convenience. I'm opposed to the concept of it. Moreover, we are a tourist beach. People park, as Uta said, they're loud, they're all over the place, they can be a nuisance. It's also what we all chose to live in. And in the midst of. The other unintended consequences, just last night I get home, and a neighbor is having a birthday party, and the spot in front of my house is taken. Where are those people going to park to go to the kid's birthday party? They have to go park five blocks away so that I can reserve that spot when I come home after dinner? It seems impractical. And I just wanted to oppose that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Paul Warren, 6 N Street. We have a new condo project coming on our street, and I want to tell you, there's 26 parking spaces with the new condo. That's a lot more than what's there now. So we look forward to it, and it's going to clean up a blighted area. So all condo projects aren't bad. The thing in our area is, and when we went from no curbs, no sidewalks, the one-sided parking kind of limited it. We also have people who put signs on their house, handicap parking and restricted parking spot and all this type of thing. And every year, I guarantee you, once a summer, the police department's down there. There's an argument going on the street over these signs on the houses. And we're told basically there's nothing they can do. These people's houses abut the street. They can put whatever they want on their house. So they're putting no parking signs on their houses. And they now think they own those spots. As the woman said, they're public spots. What happened is, and I feel sorry for the people in the back, because when we went to one-sided parking up on the letter streets, you pushed all those people to them. It's basically what happened. There's no question about it. If you go to sticker parking in the back, what's going to happen in the front? And I think Chuck, I've heard, had an idea, and I really think we should think about it as a town, is a lot of the young folks who work on a beach are people who go to school here in this town. Is an idea of giving them something where they can park in a school parking lot and bus them down to the beach. Get the business people to figure out hours where they'd have a bus from uptown to bus the kids, let them park in a high school parking lot or the academy, and bus them down to the beach. There's ways to do this, everybody wanting to work together to do it. Is it going to whatever we do, and I think as someone said last week, you may regret what you do today because it's going to have a different effect tomorrow. Thank you.
So you have 26 spots, and how many condos?
There's 20.
What is it?
20.
20.
20 condos.
20
and
condos.
26
We're
spots.
Looking forward to it. I mean, it's going to clean up a blighted area. I mean, it's already nice and quiet from what it used to be without anyone living there to knock them down. Trust me, I'm sure the cops have had a lot less calls to N Street because of it. You know, it's.
Please, no talking.
We're looking forward to it. No one on the street is complaining about it because I think it's going to be an asset to our street.
Thank you very much. Anyone else who would like to speak, please join us.
Mr. Griffin, if you don't mind while we're waiting for the next speaker, I just want to point out one thing.
Please
the gentleman
do.
Talked about the display of no parking signs. That is a violation of town ordinance. It's 805-22. Display of unauthorized signs, signals, markings, or device prohibited. And it delineates in that ordinance that you can't put up a no parking sign on your house that faces out towards the street trying to claim that spot. That is a violation of town ordinance, and we can identify who put it up there. We can summons them.
How about handicap?
Same.
Thank you.
So that's interesting. So anyone that has one on their house that's facing out, that is a violation. Thank you.
Good Please. Evening. My name is Loretta Shuck, and I live on Boston Avenue. I've been there for many, many years. I have 3 lots and 7 rental units, which I've been renting for many, many years also. and I would not like to have parking just on one side of the street. These have been in my family for many years, as well as most of the people on Boston Avenue. We're second, sometimes third generations. Our renters have been coming. I've had renters for over 40 years. They take care of the parking out front. They know who's there. They kind of direct the traffic. That was my first question. And my second is the fireworks at night, not the town, but on the beach. Yeah. I mean, they start 9:30, 10 at night. They go until sometimes 2 and 3 in the morning. We used to call the police, and they would come down. As soon as they'd leave, they'd start up again. And the other one that is very annoying and dangerous to me is the open fires in the summer. They all want a little fire on the beach, not on property, but right out on the beach. You can see the flames. Sometimes you see the ashes. You call, the fire department comes down. They go over. They have them. I've seen them put it out. They're not back at the fire station, and they're firing it up again. And that is my biggest problem because, you know, my livelihood's there, and I'd hate to have, you know, an ash or something like that. But I thank you for having this meeting. It really has, you know, opened many eyes, and I hope yours also.
Thank you
very much.
Did you want to comment on that, Chief, too, about the fireworks?
The personal fireworks are also a violation of town ordinance.
Yep.
It has been a problem since I was growing up down there. I will say this, that it is less of a problem today than it was in the past. I remember the days of walking a beat down there on the south end of the beach with that stench of the fireworks just hanging in the air. We went through a phase of strict enforcement where we would literally load up ATVs and pickup trucks full of illegal fireworks and have the fire marshal come in the next day, and we would have trash cans lined up.
Wow.
And they would take them and they'd use them for demonstrations up at the fire academy and training for the firefighters. But it has not been as big an issue for us. I know it's still there. But just be cognizant of the fact that we're dealing with staffing issues, as are a lot of departments in this town. Trying to find people to deal with those, while I know they're very bothersome to the neighbors, people in the neighborhoods, we have to prioritize what we're involved in. And parking tickets, issues with fireworks, sometimes those are a lower priority depending on what else is going on at the time.
Now, are these fire pits, they're illegal too, right?
There are no fires allowed on any state beach in the state of New Hampshire.
Yeah.
That is a state park rule, but it is also a violation of fire code. Without a permit, you can't have an open fire like that, so that's why Hampton Fire comes down and deals with it as opposed to state park personnel.
Okay, great. Thank you. Anyone else like to speak? Please join us. Come on up. The person with the, yeah. Your second time around, yes.
I just have a couple more things that I'd like to say. I'd like to get paid. But these are with the state. I walked the boulevard front. I'm working on my sugar, so I walk a lot. I see Mr. Bean running all the time. But the dog feces is terrible. Oh, my God.
Yes.
Mounds and mounds and mounds of it. It's I don't... That really needs, it's so bad that, you know, my husband and I comment every time we walk. And I don't know, they got bags there for them to pick it up, but nobody does that. So why do we allow dogs on the boulevard where people are walking, running? The Seafood Festival doesn't allow dogs when they have the Seafood Fest. Why are we having dogs? And until our water gets threatened, we're not going to be doing anything about it till our waters get threatened, because I can imagine what's on the beach. And another thing is the cigarette.
Yes.
It's terrible, too. And we put out ashtrays, and that's still another issue. And as far as the fireworks on the beach go, and on the on Boston Avenue, the police used to sneak down. They used to walk down the street to try to catch them doing it. And it worked. It worked. And I was wondering if we did pass it, there's more police officers that you're going to have. could we have a couple enforcing ordinances, just only a couple doing that all the time? And that would really be helpful. Because once it starts happening, people are going to hear it, and they're going to stop doing it. You know, if they're being fined or, you know, something if things start happening and people are hearing about it, maybe, you know, things will change. And we need change with this stuff. And I had a horse running down Boston Ave 2 years ago, and there was an intoxicated man running after it. And then I was walking the boulevard.
Is that you?
She scared me. I thought she was going to tell me there's an intoxicated officer riding the horse.
the horses are a burden. I'm walking the boulevard. Up comes this horse up the stairs. And I look and I go, if you do that, my phone comes right out now. You're first on my list.
As I am with many.
And I say, you do that, I'm calling the police. She goes down. They were going to put the horse on the street where people were walking.
Did you have anything else to say?
No, I don't.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you for your time.
Yeah.
More in 6th N Street. I don't have the date or the can't see the calendar, but I believe it's like Saturday, May 17th.
Can't see it either.
May 7th.
Is it a Saturday?
16th.
May 16th, 9 a.m., up at the pavilion and upstairs. It's when the state has their listen to the beach people.
Oh.
And that's where a lot of you folks need to go with a lot of these issues, is to that meeting. I've gone for the last several years. They have one in the spring and one in the fall.
Good.
And with a lot of these issues is where you folks need to go, because mm-hmm. that's where they want to hear
Excellent.
Complaining, like the butt cans not being emptied along the boulevard and all these other issues.
What time
it's 9 a.m., and it's upstairs in that nice thing overlooking. If you've never been there, you get to see it and tell the state what you think.
It's May 16th.
16th is a Saturday.
May 16th.
And it's a Saturday morning. It's a two-hour meeting. Anyone else like to speak for the first or the second time?
I would just throw out for consideration what the cities do.
Please, no talking in the room.
Having part-time seasonal, they used to call them meter maids, to enforce some of the parking, which wouldn't put an enormous economic burden on the department, but might get some awareness of the issue to the people who need to be more informed. Thank you.
Thank you.
If I could just address that quickly.
Please do.
After last week's meeting and hearing what the folks up at the North Shore had to say, and kind of anticipating having some knowledge of what goes on down at Hampton Beach with that area, we were not intending on having the parking enforcement folks this year. We have a lot of budgetary issues that we're concerned about. But it is one of those issues that maybe we'll have to reconsider and bring forward again. I remember several years ago we had four folks that were riding around on the bicycles that we were not utilizing in our patrol function, just because we had not had enough officers to put a class through for the bicycles. So we're using them for the parking enforcement. That is certainly something we consider again. I'll have to disagree that it is an impact. Considering the budget issues we've experienced over the last several years with the defaults, we are at that level. Trying to do more with less is not going to happen. It's not going to happen. We're going to do less with less. That's the fiscal reality of it. Can I adjust things around and try to make something work that is of obviously a great concern to our citizens? Absolutely, we can take another look at that and try. No promises, but we'll take another look at it. We have some time before the season starts. Our season doesn't officially start until June 19th with our special officers, mm-hmm. so that may be some time for us to see what we have in our accounts to try to set up four or five people that do nothing but enforce parking.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak for the first or second time?
My name's Larry Quinn. I live on Tuttle Avenue, number 18. I see a lot of multi-story condo buildings on the beach. It's a tourist town. Parking problems exist. what I'd like you to suggest to you folks is that we, as a group, consider multi-story parking garages for the beach.
Thank you. Anyone else like to speak? Before we bring it back, if anyone else wants to speak, now's your time.
I'll be quick.
Oh, that's fine.
Andrew LaCourse, 12 Atlantic Ave. Some issues were brought up that I forgot to address. Dog feces is a real issue. It's disgusting. It's unsanitary. But dog leashes are even more of a concern. I'm on the beach with my child. I have big dogs come and knock down my child. And I told one fellow, I said, put that damn thing on a leash. He said, call the police. I said, well, by the time they get here, you're going to be gone. And I'm not going to chase the guy. But it's a real concern. It's a safety issue. You know, cars driving on the beach has been a recent problem in the last couple of months. The police do get there. They towed a fellow off the beach probably last week sometime in the middle of the night. You know, I think they should be arrested for trespassing. It's a thing where if a bunch of oil spills on the beach, now there's a spot, there's the hazardous materials on the beach. And that's a real problem for the environment, I think. The snow on Atlantic Ave is another issue. I want to say Mr. Flurry runs a tight ship over at Wally's. I watch what he does, and his businesses, they've improved the beach. I don't know him personally. I've talked to him a couple times over at his establishments, but I think he runs a pretty good tight ship, and he's a pretty good neighbor, and dealing with large groups of people, he does well, I think.
Could you tell us what your address is again?
12 Atlantic Ave. One of the other issues, and it's not related to any of this, is it's my understanding that residents who rent in the winter are supposed to get a winter rental permit. And there's been several of those that it doesn't happen, and they bring dogs. They stay for 4 or 5 months. They don't register their cars here, which I'm sure they're supposed to after some short period of time, but that's one of the issues I like to
have. If anyone has any issues, like if you think your neighbors are renting without having a permit, you need to call the building department or Mr. Welch's office, but you need to, you know, sign a complaint, and it will be investigated.
Yep.
Thank you.
Anyone
else wishing to speak for the first or second time? Yep.
Again, Mike Malloy, 18 Harris Ave. Just a couple more things. You know, I live here. I have no rental property. I bought my house 11 years ago. Could have bought uptown. I love the beach, love the ocean, decided to live down on the beach. I understand that there's issues, there always has been, there always will be. But it's a quality of life thing. I decided to raise my kids here, and just going back to it, for me, that's my main concern, is my kids. And, you know, people uptown, I understand it's not that the rules don't apply up there, but if I were to go park my car in front of somebody's home uptown somewhere and try to leave my car there for a week, you know it wouldn't fly. I would imagine I'd be towed or called pretty quickly. So there's no reason why it shouldn't be a double standard for people who live here. You know, it's just, you know, I deserve the same respect as they do up there, and we don't have to get into that. But I just, you know, I'd like to think that my kids can go and not worry about the cars and the trash sitting in front of my house. The other thing, too, that new lot that's going to be going in where Clues was, the only concern I have with that is Harris Ave being the overflow. They pull in, it's full, they can't park there, they see a side street, they go down Fellows, they take a left, and they look at Harris Ave, and here's another parking lot, I can park here for free. That's going to spread like wildfire. The only thing if I may suggest for just the season, it doesn't have to be year-round, but I don't even know if it's possible, maybe from the corner of Harris and Fellows, for the season, a one-way going back out to Ashworth. That would prevent a lot of people from coming down from Ashworth and using Harris Ave as a cut-through. It would, you know, I come down P Street every day, and I cross over, and I come down Fellows to get to my house. So it would take me a couple extra minutes, too, but I think it would really cut the traffic down coming down Harris Ave and the rest of the neighborhood. There wouldn't be nobody who doesn't live down there would be coming down Dustin and taking a left on Harris and going to Fellows. It'd pretty much keep a lot of traffic out of there, I think. I think it'd help out a lot.
Chief, would you like to address about if the parking is dealt with differently uptown, or do we have the same issues, or?
No, I think what it is there are more parking issues down at the beach simply because of the congested area where they are. As far as the assertion that they would be treated differently. No, I'd have to absolutely say that that is not accurate. It's parking regulations or parking regulations. Mm-hmm. It's the manner in which they're enforced and the consistency. You have to keep in mind, be careful what you ask for, because on a lot of the roads we have in town, if you park for more than a 24-hour period and don't move the car, you'd be subject to ticket and tow under the laws of the state of New Hampshire, which we couldn't keep up with that. The number of people that park their cars out in front of their house and leave them out there for a week at a time is pretty abundant down here at the beach and uptown. We don't really bother with that much unless we get complaints in the area that there are people leaving their cars out there, and we've had to address it. But as far as the difference between the town, whether somebody would have been treated differently, no, I'll have to disagree. It's more of a profound issue at the beach because of the congestion and the number of people that come in and out on a daily basis. So thank I think you. That makes it a bigger issue to deal with.
Thank you.
Yeah, and I wasn't trying to disrespect anybody with that. I wasn't trying to say they were treated any bit differently. I was just saying that I was just putting out a scenario there that if I tried to park up there, you know, but...
I think it shows that a lot of people that are parking and they're leaving their cars overnight are people that are renting there to begin with, and that's one of the problems, and that's one of the things that we're taking into consideration.
And that's one thing. I mean, Harris Ave, and again, I don't want to speak for anyone else, but we barely have any rentals on Harris Ave. Everybody pretty much is owner-occupied, so when we're getting rental parking down at our, there's, you know, I just believe that the rentals should be parking as close to their unit as they can, and once they're four or five blocks away parking somewhere else,
unfortunately they have the right to. That's the problem.
I understand that.
Thank you.
And just
very
one
much.
Last thing, yep. Signage on Harris Ave. There's no, would be great if there was children at, with the abundance of kids that we do have playing there during the summer, children at play or a slow sign, something to that effect would be great and appreciated.
Thank you. Anyone else liking to speak? Seeing none, if no one else wants to speak, we're going to bring it back to the board. Anyone else? Seeing none, we'll bring it to the board. Mr. Wardell.
Yeah, thank you for coming, and thank you for all the comments. And I'm sure we'll take them under consideration and put something together and hopefully get back to people. But thank you. Everybody's really concerned and have some really great comments to make.
Thank you. Mrs. Woolsey?
I've got three things for a follow-up, and great, it's wonderful to see all of you come out. Mr. LaCourse, we do have a leash law in this town, and it needs, you know, if I know the dog's probably going to be gone by the time you call, but maybe you could remind the dodos. Mr. Stone, Larry?
Yep.
Larry? Hi there. On the ambulance. Since the fire stations were constructed in the new beach station...
I love the fire station. I love the police station.
I do, too.
Great job.
I do,
they
too.
They only don't keep the ambulance station.
But, well, that's what I'm trying to tell you. Station 1, instead of being at the beach with dispatch and more staffing, Station 1 is now uptown on Winneconnet Road. So you have very limited staffing at the beach. Yep. It worries me and it bothers me, but you need the staffing to get those ambulances out of there. And I agree with you. It's very foolish to be running the ambulance, especially in the summer, to the beach from uptown. But it's a staffing problem. We're short on firefighters. And one quick thing for Commissioner Ladd and the other two commissioners here tonight. Bob Ladd was nice enough to remind me that we had had a discussion before the election about Article 2 and notifying residents, particularly at the beach, particularly property owners adjacent to water in town. We need to send notices out to them regarding the passing of the flood article and what needs to be done before September 15th for property owners, and the precinct commissioners offered to share the expense with us of the postage. So we will get on that and make sure notices go out on the flood regulations and the changes. Thank you, Bob, for the reminder.
Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chief, Deputy, thank you for coming, and to those in the audience, thank you for coming and sharing. It's very important stuff, and there were some good messages. And that'll be staffed and shot by both the chairman and Mr. Welch and his department heads. Fire will respond to those pertinent things. I think when you hear about the trash issues down there and the parking issues, there's been a clamor in the past to have businesses have their own private trash pickup. And some of those comments tonight just show how impossible that would be when our own public works is challenged as magnificently as they are. Everybody's doing a great job. Budgets are tight, and there's a lot of people down there, and everybody is working and trying to cooperate. And your presence here tonight and your civility and your great input shows that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. And I would like to say, Mr. Welch, now, I know that when I was here before, I didn't hear too many people mention it last year about the fire, the ambulance, but I know that we used to have, that there was a place that the ambulance was, there was one left down there, and they put it under an awning or something like that at one point.
We now have a bay for it.
You do?
There is a bay there the ambulance can go into. Right now, the fire department is short of people. We have, I think it's six people out on workers' compensation in the fire department. So we're filling those six positions with overtime in order just to keep things running. Mm-hmm. That's very difficult because not everybody is willing to accept overtime. There are times when you have family needs and you're going to have to meet those needs as an individual. Our firefighters are very very cognizant of the problems. I believe that the reason the fire ambulance is up at the main station at the current time is because of lack of personnel and the fact that that's the center of the town. It's equidistant to all areas in the community. So we're cognizant of our response time when we get a call. We do try to keep the ambulance at the beach often, and it is down there frequently, but not on a permanent basis. So hopefully that'll change. Hopefully we get all of our personnel back. Things will operate a little differently, and we'll be able to provide a little bit better service for everybody.
We have a great deputy chief that's there that's working, and if anyone has any issues that they feel that they're directed, you know, that they're affected with, they should go over and speak at the fire department. And we're going to make sure that he knows your concerns, Mr. Stone. And we thank you for bringing them forward. So, again, we're going to take into consideration what everyone's had to say. It's very similar to what most of was being said last week. And I think the biggest priority is going to be safety. And we're looking forward to working on this problem. So thank you all for coming out tonight. Thank you for very much for coming down, if you live in another town or whatever, to take your time to come here tonight has been amazing. Thank you.
Do you want to close the hearing?
Yes.
What time?
The time is 8:20, and the hearing is closed. Please take your talking outside.
Let's go. You're on mic, just so you're
too many people to go through too narrow a door.
Well, go the bigger door.
He's going to push him out, so we're going to get him a job in New York City as a subway pusher.
Oh, we got Rich going.
Hi.
You need to get those flood letters out, Fred.
He needs to come from planning.
Well, then we need to light a fire on it. We're going to do something. Because September 15th is coming up pretty quick.
Yeah.
Less than 6 months. Is this like herding cats?
Cats don't herd.
Tell me about it.
Well, some of them do. But only in the Chronicles of Narnia. was surprised to find out today that this is the, by population and density, this is the eighth densest municipality in the state of New Hampshire.
Wow.
They're talking summer?
No, year round.
Year round.
I didn't know they sub-named that for
that him. Makes us more dense than four of the cities.
Do they mean dense?
Yeah, well, that too.
Okay, moving on to anyone that has a public comment that wasn't able to comment during the previous meeting. Anyone want to speak for public comment? Seeing none, we're moving on to announcements.
Wait, you got one.
I'm getting old.
Always got to be one.
Brian Love, I'm 27 High Street. I'm wearing multiple hats. When possible, to the chair, could I get a copy of the MS2? When available, no, when that's...
Mr. Welch, do you want to comment?
There is no more MS2.
No?
The state has changed all their forms.
Oh, great.
So, just send us an email requesting what you want, as okay. opposed to coming to the meeting, because we do need it in writing.
Okay.
All right.
I'll do that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for the information.
Moving on to announcements and community calendar. Mr. Wardell?
Yeah, I'd just like to comment that last week I went to the second grade concert at Winneconnet, and it was phenomenal. It was a patriotic, and it was really, really good. And I just want to say that the Hampton School Department, the music department, does a great job with all the concerts they put on, and I'd just like to compliment them on that.
Thank you. Mrs. Wolseley?
Nothing. I have nothing.
Mr. Bean?
Yes, I would like to publicly recognize and extend sympathies from the board for Mr. Cyphers, Roger Cyphers.
Oh, yes.
Lifelong resident business person, just an all-around great guy. Played basketball right up until just very, very recently. Legionnaire and Coast Guardsman, father, spouse, and what a remarkable guy. The choir's going to miss him at the Hampton Congo, and just wanted to share that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Great turnout at his wake.
Yeah, thank you. Moving on to the approval of minutes of April 13th.
Also move that we approve April 13th, 2015.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Our first appointment tonight is Christy Pulliman, Finance Director.
Hi, guys.
Hello.
I don't have the agenda, so I don't know what order the agenda. If the TANs first or my monthly
signing
financials?
Signing of the $4 million.
Okay. I have Ellen came last week and asked for approval, and I have all the documents here that do need to be signed. So maybe we can pass those around while
good.
I am. And there is two copies of a lot of them, but they do need original signatures on them. So everywhere where there's a sign here. So that could take care of that. Also, before I do my monthly financials, I just wanted to recognize Paul Paquette. He was nominated by Cassie Levitt, who is a fire alarm operator, to receive the it's a 2015 NHEDA Support Award for providing IT support to an emergency dispatch center. So I just wanted to recognize him and thank Brian McCain. He snuck him up there two Mondays ago, I think, to receive the award. It was a surprise to him, and I just wanted him to be recognized for that. So
thank you very much for letting us know about
that. He got that. So, and that takes care of that and the TAN. So on to the monthly financials. Let's see where they are in my pile. All right, so the financials we have in front of you are for the month of March. The target is 25%. The total income came in at $619,000. Motor vehicles came in at $274,000, which is over target by $45,000. Interest on taxes came in at $25,000. Building permits were at $19,000. Departmental income was $28,000.
The Health Trust fiscal year 2014 surplus was $227,000. That was the town's portion. And the Real Estate Trust Fund was at $39,800. The expense summary shows the operating departments without debt service but with open POs were 25.08% of the budget, which is over the month's target by $19,000. Overall, the departments as a whole are running under target, under the target of 25%. There are several subtotal lines that are either right on target or slightly over. The majority of the subtotal lines that are running over the 25% are a reflection of the quarterly slash semi-annual payments made at the beginning of the year. Under finance, the supplies and expenses and the OT wages are at 50%. That's related to the printing. The supplies is related to the printing of the town report. That's a big chunk of my supply budget. And the overtime is usually always expended at the beginning of the year. It's in relation to end of year, closing the books, and preparing for the audit. In MIS, the four equipment-related accounts, when combined together, are currently at 27.69%, which is $2,000 over the budget. The police department is at target at 21.7% overall, with the open POs included. Some accounts to note are the uniform pay, which is contractually paid out the first payroll, has to be paid out by the first payroll in April, so that's being reflected there. Fire department is also under target. They're at 21.5% when you include the open POs. Once again, they have the career incentives, which are contractually due by the payroll, the first payroll in April. Highways and streets is over target at 34.5% spent. The majority of this is due to the snow and ice removal costs, which are currently at 305% of the budget when you include the an invoice that was paid the first payroll in, or the first payable batch in April for $241,000. Municipal sanitation is running just below target at 22%. Animal control is running below target, but note that their OT wages are at 51.8%. Culture and recreation, some accounts to note there are the OT wages, telephone, and under maintenance and parks, their heating fuel. So those are some of the line items that are running over the target. On the bottom of page 15 is the accounting for the 2014 encumbrances, showing that 25% have been expended to date, and that was when this report was done. And I just checked today, and it's actually even lower than that because we've been able to clean out some more purchase orders since then. Recreation, under the special revenue funds, recreation, the beach sticker donations year-to-date equal $5,190. Cable committee, their balance continues to run slightly above the 14 ending balance, and there is not much activity in the private detail or EMS fund to report. So that is what I had for you in regards to the March financials. I don't know if you guys have any questions.
Mr. Woodall? Yeah.
Thank you, Christy. You did a good job.
And, did I go slower?
You're slower, yeah, you did speak slower. You're good. You're doing much better.
Thanks.
I just had a couple of questions.
Yep.
Number one, the OT for the animal control, do we know why that is? Or?
No, I do not.
No.
I do know that he actually, Fred might be able to correct me if I'm wrong on this, but I do believe he does do some of their snow removal down there along with their...
He does.
Their janitorial staff, I think he does. So my guess, when I saw that, it was probably related to that, but I actually didn't ask the question. But my guess is that I know that he used to do the plowing of their parking lot, I think.
That's correct.
And the snow blowing, I believe, so. Yeah.
Okay. And another one I had under general government, either for you or Fred, I guess, is that legal is only 17%. Is that lower than it usually is at this time of year, or are we making some savings there, Fred?
I'd have to look back and see if it was lower than last year.
Okay, well, I just, you know, bring that up. And there are a couple other that were real. If I can just. Oh, in the MIS, the staff development at 154.5%, 154%, and the repairs and maintenance at 142.
Repairs and maintenance, I think, is in regards to a lot of their. Well, those four lines need to be reported together because they're. We've been trying to align those accounts for the past couple years, but the budget was a default, so it's rebudgeted at whatever the old amounts are, but we're trying to charge everything to the proper line. So that's why if you add those four lines together, the repairs and maintenance, staff development, that's when you combine them together, they're only at 27.69. So every year you'll see that until we can realign those accounts to match where the spending is.
And another thing, because we're going off a default budget, sort of, are we going to run into problems with like heating fuel and stuff like that, which is at 48% on some things?
Yeah, I tried to note this time. I deviated a little bit from the financial summary that you guys have received in the past, and I kind of highlighted any accounts in any of the sections that were over target, just to bring it to your guys' attention. I didn't read all of that here because it's the same thing over and over again, but you'll see a lot of the times I did note heating fuel, diesel fuel, and those types of lines were notable in several of the different departments and stuff.
So those are something we're going to have to really keep our eye on, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it could be.
And I will continue, as long as it's fine with the board, I will continue to pull that out in my narrative to you. Just highlight those. And the financials are on the website. So if anyone at home wanted to read them, they are right there.
All right. Okay. Thank you very much.
Mrs. Wolseley.
I have three things. Christy, 2014 encumbrances, thank you, because we're no longer seeing encumbrances for two or three or whatever years back. So I appreciate you controlling it. We're one-third through the year now, so I'm hoping the rest of the encumbrances, you know, they either don't buy what they asked to buy or clear it and get it over with. Where does the money for maintaining the town website come? What I've been looking through... Where is the money? Is that coming out of the money for the
cable
committee?
Out of MIS.
Oh, out of the MIS. Yeah. Okay.
For the website, yes. Out of MIS.
Where
I would guess that most of, in regards to like licensing and stuff like that, I believe most of that he pulls out of his supply and expense line.
So the salaries are for Mr. Paquette and Dylan are coming out of the...
Their regular wages,
there it is, right here.
Yep.
Okay. And IT.
Yep.
Okay, thank you very much. And raises. Last year, as a board, we tried to bring some measure of orderliness to people getting raises, and I believe April 1st was the date if raises are to be given. Have we, I don't know whether it's appropriate for you or Fred, have raises been given out yet as of April 1st?
We passed the default budget, so everything that was in the regular budget was defeated, so therefore no raises are given to non-management, non-union employees.
Okay, thank you. I just thought I would ask. I appreciate that. Thank you, Christy. Nice job.
Mr. Bean.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. Director, great job. I have no questions.
Thank you for joining us here tonight. We appreciate it.
All right, and I just have to grab back the TMs. I have to send those off first thing in the morning.
Yeah.
I can wait over here where they get passed around.
Oh,
that's fine.
I think...
sign them and throw them over and we'll do it. Just give us a minute, Christy, and we'll get it done.
Yeah, I think that's
a TAN.
That's
Mrs. Wolseley, you didn't sign these.
Or a pen. There you go.
I don't intend to sign it.
Moving on, Mr. Burke Bennett, Commander of Post 35, please join us at the table. How are things going over there?
Very well, thank you.
That's good.
I must say that this meeting is a wonderful example of democracy in action. Our citizens voicing their concerns to our local elected officials, fielding those concerns, but more importantly, you're charged with coming up with solutions to those concerns. I think that's a wonderful thing.
We didn't even need military intervention.
No, nor police intervention. I can also attest to the veracity of the Hampton Police Department parking enforcement uptown. We had a friend of the family park in front of the house overnight during the winter parking ban, and let's just say they won't be doing that again.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Berkeley Bennett, and I live on Wayside Farm Lane in Hampton, and it is an honor to come before the board this evening. I appear before you tonight as commander of the American Legion Post 35 here in Hampton, and I speak tonight on behalf of over 300 members.
Post 35 honors a commitment to preserve the memories and incidents of our associations in the Great Wars, as outlined in the preamble of the American Legion's Constitution. And part of that commitment is remembering our fallen service members. And with that in mind, it is our honor to host the annual Hampton Memorial Day Parade and Ceremony. 2015 is the 70th anniversary of the end of World War II, and this year the Post will honor our surviving World War II veterans. We will be having four World War II veterans speaking about their experiences in the war, and we are inviting all World War II veterans from Hampton, Hampton Falls, and Northampton to join us and serve as our Grand Marshals of the Hampton Parade. On Monday, May 25th, our Memorial Day observances begin on Hampton Beach at 8 a.m. at the Marine Memorial in front of the Ashworth Hotel. Next, we will have a ceremony at 9 a.m. on Weir Common in Hampton Falls. At 10 a.m., the Northampton Parade starts off at the Citizens Bank parking lot on Route 1, which is followed by services in front of the Northampton Town Offices on Atlantic Ave. This year, the Hampton Parade will begin at 11:30 instead of 11 a.m. as in past years, to give the members of the Post a little more time to travel from the Northampton ceremony and get set up for the Hampton Parade. The parade will begin in the parking lot next to the fire department and proceed westbound on Winneconnet, north on Route 1, and east on High Street, culminating with a ceremony on High Street Cemetery. Other events Post 35 is sponsoring this year: the 8th annual Hit the Beach Wounded Warrior Program on Friday, August 28th at North Beach in Hampton. The program is spearheaded by Post 35 Past Commander Ralph Fatello, and last year we had 20 wounded warriors spend the day at the beach and experiencing surfing, with the support of over 80 volunteers on the beach, many from our local surfing community. The 9/11 Global War on Terrorism Monument Rededication Ceremony, Friday, September 11th, at Post 35 on High Street. The monument honors those members of our armed forces from New Hampshire who have given their lives in service to our country during the global war on terrorism since September 11, 2001. Last year, we were honored to have the American Legion National Commander, Mike Helm, as well as Governor Maggie Hassan attend. Over 200 people attended, many of them families of the fallen. And I cannot tell you what an emotional experience it is to meet with these families, embrace them, and listen to them tell us how grateful they are that we remember their loved ones. And finally, we have the Veterans Day ceremonies Wednesday, November 11th. They'll be at Hampton Beach Marine Memorial at 8 a.m., Hampton Falls on Weir Common at 9 a.m., Northampton at 10 a.m. in front of the town offices, and Hampton at 11 a.m. in front of Post 35 on High Street. And since many events involve costs to the Legion, and unlike many posts, we don't have a bar for income, we hold several fundraisers during the year. We have the Post 35 yard sale on Saturday, May 16th at the Post on 69 High Street. The Post welcomes all donations, so clean out your garage, basement, and attic and give to a good cause. Our primary fundraiser is the second annual Post 35 golf tournament on Friday, June 12th at the Breakfast Hill Golf Club in Greenland. Last year's tournament was very successful, and Auto Fair Nissan of Stratum is once again sponsoring a hole-in-one concert, in which the prize is a 2015 Nissan Rogue.
Ooh.
And if I just might take another moment to highlight some of the other projects the Post have that doesn't get much visibility. Post 35 is proud to be the charter organization of Boy Scout Troop 177 in Hampton, and with their help, we ensured that every veteran's grave in all of Hampton cemeteries, from the Revolution to the present day, over 975 in all, is decorated with a flag for Memorial Day. On Flag Day, June 14th, the Post, with the support of the Hampton Fire Department, and once again with the help of Boy Scout Troop 177, honorably disposes of unserviceable flags in a ceremony at the Hampton Fire Department. We award two scholarships to graduating Winneconnet High School seniors, and the Post also provides school awards to graduating 8th grade students of the Hampton Academy and Sacred Heart School, as well as the Northampton School and Lincoln Anchorman School in Hampton Falls. All of the school awards recognize the qualities of courage, honor, leadership, patriotism, and service. We assist at the annual Run for the Fallen at Odeon State Park, which is held the Sunday after September 11th. The run is dedicated to the same service members whose names are on our monument, those from New Hampshire who have laid down their lives for the cause of freedom since 9/11. Active in the community, Post donates Thanksgiving baskets during the holidays, but also participates in the Hampton School System's Giving Tree program, ensuring local families who might need a little helping hand enjoy a happy holiday season. We hold memorial services for those veterans who have passed. Our most recent service was last Friday for Roger Cyphers. Roger was not only a longtime member of our post and a former officer, but he played a very large part in the erection of our Global War on Terrorism monument. And finally, we sponsor programs that enrich the lives of young men and women in our community. We hold the American Legion Oratorical Contest, a constitutional speech program for high school students. And Post 35 also actively supports the American Legion Boys State Program, a highly respected and selective program of government instruction for high school junior boys. I must mention that we are indebted to the principals and staff at Winnicott High School for helping to administer these programs in the school. And in closing, I would like to mention that there were some stories in the press recently that wondered if veteran service organizations like the American Legion and the VFW were dying out due to lack of membership and because they are no longer relevant to the younger veterans of today's military. We at Post 35 recognized this challenge before the stories broke, and we are hard at work in making the post more attractive to the younger Iraq and Afghanistan veterans. We are not a bunch of old guys sitting at the bar drinking beer, telling old war stories. We are actively engaged in our community. We are recruiting younger veterans, and some of them now hold leadership positions within the post. In fact, one of our newest members, Alan Arbo, is building a new website for us, post35.us. And although it is still a work in progress, the site will not only make it easier for us to communicate with our members, but will also be a way of informing the public of our activities. He is helping us drag the post kicking and screaming into the 21st century. And on membership, we have 308 members. And out of 99 American Legion posts in the state, we are one of 10 posts who have exceeded their membership goals for the year for the seventh year running. So we must be doing something right. And a major test of the viability of Post 35 is this. If we closed our doors tomorrow and disbanded, would the community miss us? And I think the answer is a resounding yes. I am grateful this year for the support and assistance of not only the Board of Selectmen, Town Manager Fred Welsh, Administrative Assistant Christina Osman, Chief Sawyer in the Hampton Police Department, Chief Ayotte in the Hampton Fire Department, but also for all the support from the citizens and businesses of Hampton, especially Desi Lanio of the 401 and Reverend Tim Lewis of the New England Shores Baptist Church. Your support makes it possible for us to carry out our mission, not only one of veterans helping veterans, but also one of giving back to the community. Thank you.
Yeah. Where is that Baptist church at?
The New England Shores Baptist Church actually holds services in the post on Sundays, and they have a Bible study on Wednesday evenings for the children.
Well, that's very nice.
And they've been very, very generous to us, in addition to being our primary runner, but they're also very, very generous to us. So we'd like to applaud them.
Thank you for recognizing them. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you for this opportunity.
Mr. Wardell, would you like to comment?
Yeah, thank you for your service, all of you. And also, thank you for the great job you do with the Post and the great involvement in the community. You guys do a super job. I mean, very proud.
Thank you. We're trying to do more.
Mrs. Wolfley?
Yes, Commander, if you would let Mr. Welch know when you have the website up and running, because I think it would be nice if we could notify the residents of the town. And your yard sale is what date?
May 16th.
16th.
May 16th.
What time?
8 to 2.
8 to 2. Right on site at the...
Right at the post.
Now...
I brought my support staff with me.
I love it.
I don't have the answer. Somebody does. Yes,
I mean, it's is it kind of going to be like leaving the baby on the porch, or how do I donate? What hours are you open, or what's the format for donating?
If you have something to donate, Mrs. Woolsey, if you give us a call at the post, we will make.
Okay, great. Because you did give me the number before the meeting, so thank you very much.
Yes, ma'am.
Then I will use that. I appreciate that. Yeah,
if you wanted to call the post number for that, that would be most advantageous.
I will. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
And it's nice to see all of you.
Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commander, Sergeant Major, Legionnaires, very well done. Carry on. Thank you.
Thank you. Just keep drilling down.
Thank you very much for coming in this evening. Next on the agenda, we have Tom McGurk, M Street Traffic Direction.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening, board members. I'm Tom McGurk. It was posted that this is a conversation regarding the direction of traffic during the summer of M Street. That is only part of what I'm here for, because quite honestly, I don't live anywhere near M Street. I live on J Street, three blocks away. But the direction of traffic on M Street does affect my neighborhood very adversely. And I, had planned to come to the board before I even knew that we were having a conversation earlier tonight. So I do appreciate that you are granting me this opportunity to come up and speak on this. I needed a couple more minutes than just 2 minutes anyways. I just want to explain to you a little bit about the neighborhood that I live in. I live on Auburn Ave during the summertime. Auburn Ave is a 14-foot street.
Yeah.
And it is connected to Perkins Ave via the extension, Auburn Ave extension, which is 175 feet from Ashworth Avenue. Okay, and so a couple different things that affect us is K Street being the last up street and K Street being north of Perkins Avenue. People on Perkins Avenue use Auburn Ave extension as a throughway at very high speeds.
Great.
To come down our 14-foot street on Auburn Avenue. We have a lot of children on Auburn Avenue. Auburn Ave is one of the rare streets on Hampton Beach because we don't have any turnover on Auburn Ave. The same families have been there since the 60s. I think the last person to move in on Auburn Ave was Terry Sullivan back in the 80s. And so, the Houle family lives there, who owns the Harrisy Ranch Motel. The O'Neill family, the McGurk family, the Sullivan family. And so, we've been there forever and ever and ever. And, we do have a lot of children. There are 30 grandchildren in my family. My parents have 30 grandchildren who all live on either Auburn Ave Extension, the end of Perkins Ave, or Mooring Drive. And they use Auburn Ave as their way to the beach, walking. There are no sidewalks. We don't have any parking issues on Auburn Ave because we don't have any public parking. So the it's mainly people driving basically like a bat out of hell to get up K Street. Somebody's going to get hurt. Someone absolutely is going to get hurt. It was so bad that last year my sister posted up signs. She went to all the telephone poles and she put up these signs that said, caution, children playing. And she says to me, "What do you think of those signs?" I said, "Oh, they're nice. Who put them up?" "Oh, I did." it doesn't help at all, because I think the people that are going to obey those signs are the people who are already going to be driving slowly. I know back in the 80s when they started changing the directions of the leaded streets, it was to curb the cruising and, basically kids going around and around and around and around and around. And, back in the 80s when I was a kid, I never cruised because I never get in a car because I lived here. But that did happen. I worked for the casino and I'd watch the people go around and around and around. That doesn't happen to the extent that it did, back in the 80s. It's a different era. They have different ways of
meeting people, communicating, whatever they're doing. So I think that that is an outdated model for changing that street. M Street is the same width and the same length as every other street. So I think it was pretty arbitrary that M Street was the street that they decided was the starting point of changing. You know, I'm not suggesting that you change O Street. I'm not suggesting that you change Q Street. I think that those streets are very short, and if they went up from Ashworth Avenue, it only takes about 5 cars to back up onto Ashworth Avenue. So I'm not suggesting that you change the direction of those streets. But M Street being the same length as K Street, you know, quite honestly, what's the difference? You know, but I don't think that M Street should have a benefit of not having anybody waiting to turn onto Ocean Boulevard at the detriment of this small little neighborhood on Auburn Ave. The other thing that I think is why it's imperative for this year and, you know, continuous years too, we're going to have a major construction project on that street. Mm-hmm. You know, at the Summer Wind is coming down at 128 Ashworth, and 32 condos are going up. Yep. So we're going to be seeing construction in that neighborhood. You know, similar to the N Street condos, nobody in that neighborhood is opposed to that project. We're actually welcoming that project. You know, so we're thrilled to have it. But we're going to be seeing a greater amount of traffic just with construction. So if we could, you know, consider leaving M Street and Up Street, I think that it would help.
Questions for Mr. McGuirk?
No.
Mr. Wardell?
Can we pass this on to the chief along with the other problems that were noted here tonight so Chief Sawyer can consider that when he's putting his recommendations together for us?
Up to the board. Mm-hmm. Certainly can.
Yes. I mean, I would appreciate it if Tom's...
Yeah. Right. I'm not looking for an answer tonight. Absolutely. No. Public safety is...
But you've talked to the chief of police before,
yes.
So he's aware of this.
Yeah.
Okay.
And we will remind him just in case, but you might want to talk to him again because pretty much I think what's going to happen is going to be a lot to have to do with what the police recommend.
Oh, absolutely.
So we'll make sure that he hears it, and if you see him around town, I'd bring it up again.
And put it in his ear, absolutely. Okay.
Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. McGuirk, thank you for coming in tonight, and I have no questions.
Thank you.
And thank you for coming in, and thank you for helping with the crowd.
Oh, absolutely.
But
public comment?
No public comment, please.
Why?
It's
on the agenda.
Public comment was at the beginning of the meeting, Mrs. Wolseley.
Oh.
And
public comment was before the public hearing?
We had public comment.
You had a public hearing.
We mentioned public comment. Thank you.
Okay. I just didn't hear it.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
I just
now we have the town manager.
You looked at it as highway safety.
Thank you, Walter. Okay. Thank you. Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board. The Department of Public Works has pushed back all the stored snow and opened the Ashworth and Island Path parking lots, except for a very few spaces at the very back. And I looked at them today, and they're melting like crazy. So, and so is our small little pile up at the state beach, the state park. At one point, that was 3.5 stories tall.
Ooh.
It is now down to about one story. And melting feverishly. I'm sure in a few weeks most of it will be gone. The Department of Public Works opened bids for the repaving of Exeter Road, Belmont Circle, Fairfield Drive, and Ruth Lane. Evaluations are currently ongoing, and the department reported to me today that they will have a recommendation for your next meeting, and it appears from the bid documents that we're going to save a considerable amount of money in the paving.
Good.
That means we can do more paving in the appropriation. The finance department is working on closing figures regarding our unusual snow plowing and removal costs for January through March. With good planning, we should have those figures to the board within the next 2 weeks. and a recommendation on how to proceed with the over budget. The uninvited guest, which has been beached in the marsh behind Tuttle and Fellows Avenues, has been acquired by the state, and arrangements are in progress to repair the hull and move the boat to Newburyport. They apparently have found a buyer for it, as opposed to originally scrapping it and hauling it out in pieces. I have appointed a review committee to examine the physical layouts of the North Beach streets and the issues discussed at the selectmen's meeting. The chief of police, the acting fire chief, the town planner, the public works director, the assistant town manager will join me in preparing recommendations for the board's consideration in the very near future. I was asked to plug the food drive non-perishable items for the United States Postal Service, which is going to be held on Saturday, May 9th, 2015. Please put your non-perishable donations in a bag by your mailbox for Saturday morning, the 9th of May, and they will be picked up by our friends in the Post Office Department and taken care of. I gave each of you a little report that came from our Public Works Director on April 24th, and my understanding is that it's a simple one-page report on what the department's doing. My understanding is that the department's going to attempt to do this each and every week, so you should see another report at the end of this week to show you what progress they're making in various areas and various items. I'll leave that for you to read as opposed to me to expound upon it. I've also received a communication from the Department of Safety, the Highway Safety Agency, issuing three grants to our police department. One of those is for overtime reimbursement for selective traffic enforcement programs. One is for overtime reimbursement for selective programs dealing with sobriety checkpoints and active enforcement of DWI. And the other is a similar program for later on this year for enforcement of DWI. Mr. Chairman, there's only one other thing, and I call the board's attention to, I know our good senator and one of our representatives filed a bill, Senate Bill 242, to amend the state statutes regarding deliberative sessions and the SB 2 program. I find it a little confusing, but I'm sure we'll be able to work through it if it does pass. Just to give you an idea of what's pending in the legislature, and you may wish to contact representatives and other people you know up there to express your desires regarding it. Basically, it says if the operating budget as amended at the first session, each amendment is set forth shall be set forth in a separate warrant article immediately following the operating budget as follows. They have a particular language that is going to be set. So if there's 25 amendments to the budget, there will be 25 separate warrant articles placed within the budget, within the warrant, for each one of those amendments. The town will then vote separately on the default budget and separately on the town budget. So it should be very interesting because Hampton has the reputation of leaving no stone unturned to find out what needs to be done with the budgets, and I'm sure that we will have a number of special warrant articles dealing with this subject should this bill pass. And that's it, Mr. Chairman.
Questions for the town manager, Mrs. Wolseley.
Yes, I have several items. We did get a memo, Fred, from Aquarian on the 17th, and I just think the public should know what's in this. Please let your staff know that Aquarian will have a contractor conducting a leak survey of the water system over the next 6 weeks. The work will be performed by New England Water Distribution Services and will involve inspections of valves and mains, some of which are located in road right-of-ways. A portion of this work will also involve night surveys. Just in case the public sees something that they think is suspicious or a problem, the water company is undertaking that survey. The red lists of bridges, and thank you for giving us that information. We have a memo from Mr. Jacobs about the state bridge replacement over the Taylor River, and he went to the pre-construction
conference, and the bridge over the Taylor River and the Underwood Bridge at Hampton Beach are both on that list. Mr. Jacobs said all of the bridge work, and this is for the Taylor River Bridge, lies within the boundaries of the town of Hampton. A portion of the ramp and other drainage work lies in Hampton Falls. I would recommend that the fire department determine how they can respond to the area. Do you have additional questions or problems as far as possible contamination goes? Because we've discussed that in the past.
We have, and the state has taken the position that they're going to not move the contaminated material behind the current dam at this time. They do have a study underway to determine whether or not they should remove that material and take it to a secure landfill, or whether they should just simply breach the dam and allow it to go into the marsh and into the harbor. As you know, we had hired a consultant, and we had some very thorough examination made of the material behind there. There is DDT contamination in that silt, along with other things that are or have been in the past used in the upstream orchards. We're keeping a close eye on it. We understand that they are going to be taking 3 years to replace the bridge. At that time, they will make a decision on what needs to happen with the dam. So it's going to be a while before we have an indication from them as to how they're going to proceed.
Do we have anything from them in writing that they will not breach that in the process of doing this construction?
That's part of the permit they've received from the EPA and the,
okay,
and the state. So
that's stipulated.
Unless the dam fails.
Oh, great.
You've got to remember, this dam was built in the late 1940s, early 1950s.
Yeah.
It's metal. It's completely rotted through in some areas of the top of the dam.
Oh.
But apparently the face of the dam is pretty solid at this point. Of course, it's covered with silt and other material. We don't think there'll be a failure, and they're trying desperately to preserve it in its current position.
Next, you provided us with something called Town of Hampton Expenditures Related to Hampton Beach. Expenditures is misspelled, but nevertheless, there's no documentation on this. There's no date on it. There's no provenance on it. Where did we get this?
This information came from the individual departments.
Okay.
And if I gave you the information, I probably need a truck to haul it down here.
No, well, I don't need the truck, but this is recent. This is April of 2015.
This material has been gathered by the departments for the last 2.5 years.
Okay, so this is a current report.
That's
basically
a current report. It was just done, and we formulated that from 2.5 years worth of data.
Okay. Because we had other data that was given to us, I think, 2 years ago that I put in my binder for the budget committee.
Right.
So this is follow-up.
This is follow-up. This is a conclusive statement of from the departments, a compilation of their information on what it costs us to do business with the state of New Hampshire at Hampton Beach.
Okay, I appreciate that. Are we going to have on the agenda fairly soon up about cleanup in the town forest?
Interesting question.
I thought it would be.
Yes, it always is.
Before I get too excited.
Yeah, we have to. Well, please don't get excited. We have to. We have to get together with the Conservation Commission, and since they have control of that facility,
right,
they're going to have to set the program up for us to say what needs to be done.
Good.
And that's something that's currently being discussed. So
they are aware of the problem.
Well, they are aware of the problem, and we have to sit down and discuss this with them and Public Works, along with Police and Fire Department.
Mm-hmm. And my last item regards the Gristmill Dam. I noticed that there are communications in here with the engineers, et cetera, your letter of April 24th. Are we tracking to make sure that these estimates, it looks like we're getting on top of them for not spending money that they shouldn't be spending. But do we think we're going to come in on budget? When will we know?
Talking the Gristmill or the ice pond?
Gristmill. This is Stevens on the Gristmill.
They do both, so.
Oh, well, this appears to be the Gristmill, although it's not stipulated in here, but it is doing Stevens Associates. Your letter of April 24th?
I believe it's the Stevens, and I believe it deals with it deals with the Ice Pond Dam, not with the Grist Mill Dam.
You think that's the Ice Pond?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Thank you. It just would have helped.
Yeah, we're trying to work through all the town meeting warrant articles that were passed.
Yeah.
So we've asked for the information that's necessary to formulate the program for replacement and the bid documents and the plans and construction drawings that are necessary under the program to get the work done.
Okay, because we're going to make sure that we're not having overruns, I'm assuming.
Well, there's no guarantee of that. I mean, obviously, we're 3.5 years down the road on what's going on, and are we having a problem with the engineers? Yes, we are.
Okay, I appreciate that. And I think that's it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Your thing is hidden.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. Mr. Welch, I have no questions.
Thank you, sir.
I wanted to ask, I wanted to remind...
Mr. Chairman.
Oh, I'm sorry. I almost forgot you. I was calling you first all night.
Yeah, you were. Okay. Thank you. You're a good man.
We're back to the closer.
Yeah, 242 is going to a study committee, I think.
Yeah, that's what I heard.
That's what I heard.
It hasn't gone there yet.
Yeah.
But it's something that needs to be carefully looked at.
Yeah.
There's obviously a...
happening there. And how come the state decided uninvited guest? They changed their mind?
Well, actually, I'm the one who termed it the uninvited guest, but it's the guest. The name of the ship is the guest. Yes, they were having difficulty getting the equipment into the marsh while it was frozen to demolish the boat and take it away. So someone recently came to them and offered to repair it so it could be floated and haul it to Newburyport for refurbishment. So understanding is the state is working on that, and they expect to haul it out and haul it to Newburyport and have it refurbished. Hmm.
Good deal. And you said that the bids are coming in lower on Exeter Road?
Yeah. Yeah. We're very surprised, but it's good.
Nice.
There's nothing wrong with that. So.
No, it's great. It's good. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
I was just going to, I would like the public to know that we have taken a position on this pollution in the Taylor River.
Yes.
And we spent a lot of money on...
We did.
A study. So it's not something that just hasn't, that we haven't been paying attention to. It's.
No, we actually hired one of the recognized best professionals in the New England region, New England, New York region. In fact, she's recognized nationally. She came in and examined the material that's in behind the dam. They did tests on the material behind the dam as the state has done. And we were warned that should that material be released and go into the harbor, it may kill the harbor. It may kill the estuary because of all the DDT and other chemicals that are in it. So we have told the state rather emphatically, as a matter of fact, that we expect if the dam is to be taken down, that they have to take the 77,000 cubic yards of material out. And the answer was, we'll think about it, but right now, no.
And were they given a copy of the study?
Oh, yes.
Yeah,
Yeah. They were a little envious because we hired the person they probably wanted to hire, but we got there first. So.
Okay. And I just wanted to comment on the grist mill. What was the gentleman that was in charge of?
Mr. Hurley?
Yes.
Yes. Now there is a new person that's the key person there. It's Jim Metcalf. Oh.
I've just heard from Mr. Hurley today. They're preparing their documents to bring them in and discuss the warrant article that has submitted by petition with us.
Mm-hmm.
We need basically to start from scratch and see what they're going to do.
Yeah.
But we're trying to put together and assemble the resources that are necessary within the appropriation to get the work done. Mm-hmm. The same with the ice pond dam.
Yeah, I talked with Mr. Metcalf, and I suggested he come and talk with you.
Yeah.
And he's a very competent person. person, so I think you'll enjoy working with him
Good.
When he comes by.
We need some help getting this done.
Thank you. Moving on to new business.
Mr. Chairman, could I politely Yes. recommend that we hear the Bartels? They've been patient this
Okay.
evening. We could move them up. They are under all business, Roman 1, or actually number 1, Land Lease, Real Estate Commission, 33 through 35.
Yes, if I might, I've given the board a memo on the subject. The Bartels contacted me subsequent to the arbitration that occurred, whereby the Leaseland Real Estate Commission conducted an arbitration proceeding and set a price. The Bartels, the Leaseland Real Estate Commission did not address the issue of when, by when the closing was to occur. And so what then happened was the Bartels asked, contacted me and asked me what kind of time frame was involved, and indicated that their bank had said to them that a period of up to 6 months might be necessary for the all the various financial dealings to be brought together for the purchase and might be more advantageous to them. I indicated that they should write a letter to the selectmen about the subject. I then saw what their request actually was, and I looked then at the vote of the town meeting back in 1982 setting up this program, and then at the state session law governing the Real Estate Commission, because subsequent to the town meeting vote in 82, it took a state session law to create the Leaseland Real Estate Commission. And it appears that according to that session law, it is really the Real Estate Commission that is supposed to deal with the consummation of the implementing the sale of leased land. So I would recommend respectfully, I'm sorry that the Bartels have sat here, that the issue of when their closing may occur be referred to the Leaseland Real Estate Commission, as opposed to this board making a decision.
Okay. Did the Bartels want to have something to say by any chance? If you do, why don't you come on up to the podium, since this is on the agenda.
Hi, I'm Burley Barthel, and I really didn't expect to say anything, and this has kind of caught us by surprise, because we started this process almost a year ago, I think, when we first submitted our bid. And because of the, I guess, the Lease Land Committee not having the right number of members and everything, it sort of delayed and everything. And I'm just, my only concern is, like, how much longer will this delay than that process? If I understand it, that we asked for 6 months to, or sooner, to close on the land. And what I'm hearing the town council saying is that that will be up to the Lease Land Committee, so we have to basically send the same note that we sent to the town selectman and address it to, I guess, Chairman McGurk,
Lease Land Committee? I'm just asking this board to refer your letter to the Real Estate Commission.
Yeah, well, Mr. McGurk is on the lease land, right?
Yes.
He's the chairman.
Yes.
Yeah. So is that who they need to be in contact with, or?
Yes, once this board, since it's on your agenda, if you move to refer it to the Lease Land Commission, we would bring this letter to the attention. They don't need to write another one.
Okay.
And that board is now fully constituted, and having made its decision recently, I think won't have the same kind of delay we'd experienced before. Yeah.
And do we have a full board there now?
You have 3 out of a potential 5. You at least have a
I think there's another person that's interested, so we're trying to get that taken care of, but there'll be enough to make a decision there. So did you have any questions further?
Well, no, I guess the question was, do we need to direct the letter, or?
No, we're going to do that for
okay.
you. But thank you very much. We appreciate it. Do we need to make a motion?
Yes.
I'll make a motion that we did.
Is there a second?
Okay. We have the motion here. Do you want me to read it really quickly? Well, council did the motion up.
Do we need that?
Sure.
Yeah.
I hereby move to refer the request of Helena Barthel and Burley Barthel as to a closing date deadline for purchase of 33-35 Dover Ave to the Leased Land Real Estate Commission for their determination in accordance with the May 11, 1982 town meeting vote, creating the Leased Land Sales Program, and the terms of the 1983 state session law, creating the Leased Land Real Estate Commission. I have a second.
I'll second.
Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Unanimous.
I'm abstaining.
Abstaining. One abstention. Thank you for coming in tonight. We're sorry that didn't catch that. Thank you.
Interesting.
The now we're going to go back to
new business.
New business, RSAs, inquiries. Mr. Bean, did you want to?
Thank you. Yes, I did want to bring this up. This came to light last week when I spoke or was informed by the town manager that the town council had informed him of Selectman Woolsey in a discussion with town council. And I'm concerned for a number of reasons about their phone call, and I'm going to ask town council to discuss it. One is to have simple telephone calls with the town council and then to claim confidentiality on those discussions when the subject of the telephone call is not confidential in and of itself, and especially in light of the fact that in March, Selectman Woolsey, under case number 218-2015-CV-00300, sued everybody on this board, the town of Hampton, and she prayed for the honorable court as follows in letter C, especially in these difficult budget times, that the petitioner, which would be Ms. Woolsey, be awarded her legal fees for having to file this petition. So I would ask Attorney Giroir to discuss that phone call and the genesis of it.
Last Wednesday, I received a phone call from Selectman Woolsey asking me, in general, what the powers and duties of the Board of Selectmen were, where those items were addressed in the RSAs, and we then got into a brief discussion about the oath of office and what RSA provisions govern that. I pointed her in the direction of the particular sections that generally discuss those items, and the phone call concluded at that point. I drew this to the attention of the manager because given the I wasn't sure what the concerns, if there were particular concerns, but the manager deals with all of you and relations among the selectmen, and I wasn't quite sure where this might be coming from, so I drew that to his attention. The next day, he recommended to me that when I get inquiries of this type, calling for most of the time, as you know, the inquiries that I'm to answer, legal inquiries, come from this meeting. He recommended that when I get inquiries like that, that I should send an email to all the board, because the confidentiality that comes from discussions with me extends to the entire board, that I should share what I shared with Ms. Woolsey.
Okay.
And that was done.
And thank you. I've got further follow-on, Mr. Chairman. Chapter 41, Choice and Duties of Town Officers, 41-8, that the town council refers to it. Every town at the annual meeting shall choose by ballot one selectman to hold office for 3 years. The selectman shall manage the prudential affairs of the town and perform the duties by law prescribed. The challenging part of that chapter, of course, is a majority of the selectmen shall be competent in all cases. That is 41-8. When I was informed by the town manager of this discussion, you emailed the board on 4/23.
And number two, you allude to a discussion with Ms. Woolsey, which has no confidentiality, as to which RSA governs the oath of office and removal for violation of same. Please see RSA 42:1 and 42:1(1) and (2). What is the genesis of that specific response from counsel to Ms. Woolsey? Please, sir.
That came in the course of discussion of the provisions of oath of office and what sections govern that and what could be done for a violation of oath of office.
Thank you very much. And I wanted to shed light on that. This inquiry has no confidentiality. We are in a limited budget. There are requests that we'll address later on tonight by the budget chair for expenditures out of the legal budget. And I want to make sure that when we have good people that are in the town that come tonight and they know with all the demands that are placed on municipal services, we heard tonight about snow removal, we're hearing about deficits, we hear about people that are reducing the demand for services, and it appears that whether it's a court action last month and using the town clerk to notarize that information by Ms. Woolsey, or to foist unnecessary work demands about harebrained schemes that we feel that we can take the town council's time as elected leaders in, I think, an inappropriate manner. And that's what I'd like to share with you tonight, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you.
May I respond?
Please.
Thank you. I did not expect any confidentiality from counsel. I simply asked him if I'm not to call him, then that's fine. I have no problem with that. However, at the start of my remarks, I caution you and the viewing audience that while my comments may be uncomfortable to some, the statutes require that any criticism of an elected official or officials must take place in public. What I have to say here tonight cannot be said behind closed doors. Last year, we performed our duties with at least a veneer of cooperation. On Monday, March 16th, at the reorganization of this board, you chose to disrespect me and my service to this community by refusing to allow me to serve as chair. That decision was made behind my back even before we sat down in public to take a vote. On Tuesday, March 17th, as the selectman representative to the Budget Committee, I reported to their regular monthly meeting. After serious consideration on Wednesday morning, March 18th, I called alternate selectman Representative Bridle and told him that I refused to represent this board because I no longer trust my colleagues and will not disrespect the Budget Committee by working with them under false pretenses. After a contentious year of poor relations with that committee, I had offered to serve as your representative, relying on my many years of service as a member at large, chairman, and select man representative. I hoped to bring a measure of cooperation so that the committee would be better prepared to conduct 2016 budget deliberations this fall. At that March 17th meeting of the Budget Committee, I participated in discussions, answered questions, and listed inquiries from the members that I promised to follow up. I emailed Chairman Latimer the following day with the best responses that I could provide. While at that meeting, I suggested, since we are starting a very important reval year, that the Budget Committee members could profit by starting their work sessions in April with a presentation by Assessing Officer Ed Tinker. I had checked with Mr. Tinker before making that suggestion to see whether he would be open to such a presentation, and with his usual obliging spirit, he agreed. Chairman Latimer followed up with him a few days after the March meeting, and they settled on an appropriate format. I informed all of you that I made that suggestion. It seemed a non-controversial way to start the new budget year. On Tuesday, April 21st, I watched the telecast of the regular monthly meeting and was appalled by the arrogant remarks made by Selectman Representative Bean. After witnessing his comments and hasty departure from that meeting, leaving a flabbergasted group of elected officials in his wake, I want to give you the following considerations. Number one, according to Mr. Bean's statement of record on April 21st, he and Chairman Griffin made a decision that day to direct Mr. Welch to inform Mr. Tinker that the board would not allow him to make his scheduled appearance before the Budget Committee that evening. Number two, I was never consulted by either of them before this unlawful action. Number three, I have no idea whether Mr. Bridle, the alternate, and or Mr. Waddell were consulted. Number four, the assessing officer works in lieu of the Board of Selectmen, and no town manager has any authority over him. This is an unacceptable position in which to place both the manager and the assessor. Number five, two members of this or any other board have no authority to act outside the jurisdiction of the five members. Number six, the chairman of the budget committee was never notified in advance that Mr. Tinker had been forbidden to attend the April 21st meeting. Number seven, Mr. Bean, in his unforgivingly insulting remarks to the budget committee, claimed that he consulted with Chairman Griffin and they ordered Mr. Tinker to not attend. He ranted about the 2015 budget, which is a dead issue, saying from now on he orders that all requests from the budget committee go through him and he will only work with Chairman Latimer and no members of the budget committee have a right to question department heads, etc. Chairman Latimer had told her committee members that all requests for information related to the budget must go through her, and she has a right to stipulate that for the sake of orderliness. But all members of any committee have rights as residents and taxpayers and can ask any questions of anyone in government at any time. I refer to the Budget Committee Statute, RSA 32, quoting from RSA 32, 16, Roman 2. To confer with the governing body or bodies and with other officers, department heads, and other officials relative to estimated costs, revenues anticipated, and services performed to the extent deemed necessary by the Budget Committee. It shall be the duty of all such officers and other persons to furnish such pertinent information to the Budget Committee, end quote. A selectman representative is meant to be a facilitator, not a dictator. I have more experience serving with and on the Municipal Budget Committee than any of you, all of you, sitting here. I'm appalled at the disrespect shown to the committee, which sat in stunned silence after outrageous statements by Selectman Bean and his cowardly retreat at the conclusion of his remarks. It is illegal for Selectman Bean and or Selectman Griffin to make such a decision on his or their own without concurrence from this board. And the manager was drawn in as party to this conspiracy against the greater interests of the board. I am furious at the embarrassment inflicted on the most competent, outstanding assessing officer that I have known since I entered public office in 1978. Mr. Tinker was told by the manager at the explicit direction of Mr. Bean that the board ordered him to not attend that night's budget meeting, which is an outright lie. The mission of any and all elected officials is first and foremost to serve the best interests of the public. Personalities have no place in public office. This is not a men's club. It is impossible to achieve any lasting benefits to a community when members of any board sneak around behind the backs of the duly elected officials. And you are the board that rejected my suggestion that we have a joint public meeting with the planning board to iron out areas of concern. You said we aren't supposed to tell other elected officials what to do. Preposterous. I am one-fifth of this board, and I refuse to put up with sneaking, disrespectful, illegal conduct. How am I to fulfill my oath to the taxpayers of Hampton? Did the public vote for conduct like this? We cannot continue to sanction this behavior and accept to accomplish anything this year. And quite frankly, I intend to call for a conference with Town Council before next week's meeting because I think Mr. Bean should step down as a representative of this board.
I have
no idea what Mr. Griffin's involvement, if any, may have been.
And I'm going to, because no comments from the audience, please. I will, because I've been accused, I will say that when Mr. Bean stopped to see me, what he asked me was that we have made a decision as a board that all items go through the representative, which, Mrs. Woolsey, you were the representative, and you stepped down. I was under the impression because you didn't get along with Mrs. Latimer when she was there.
Oh, I told Mr. Bryles.
Well, Mrs. Latimer told me the same thing.
No, so, I should tell Mr. Bryles.
Mrs. Woolsey, please let me have my say. I was under the impression that you weren't getting along there, and that's why you left the planning board. Well, that's what it appeared
at
the budget committee.
Well, you did come and you gave up your place. You did not have to.
Because I said I didn't
I'm
want
sorry,
to represent
Mrs.
you.
I'm sorry, Mrs. Wolseley. Let me have
I
my
didn't
talk.
Want to represent
let
you.
Me have my time to say something.
Sneaky.
You are the one that asked not to be on the budget committee. So that's when Mr. Bean took yeah. over that position. Now, are you asking now to be back on the budget committee?
What I'm saying to you, because you've asked me the question, number one, I said I refused to represent a board that went behind my back. And number
no
two,
one went behind your
yes,
back,
you did.
Mrs. Wolseley.
Yes, you did.
No, next, okay, please.
No,
you wait till let me finish my conversation.
No, you asked me a question.
Mrs.
Stop
Wolseley,
banging the
please.
Damn gavel. You asked
Mrs.
me a question,
Wolseley,
and I'm going to
please.
Answer it.
Let me
I'm
have.
Gonna
I'm going to finish my conversation.
No, Mr. Well, none of us, as a board, ever. The appointment with
you
Mr.
Are
Tinker.
Out of line,
I'm
Mrs.
not
Wolseley.
Out of line. Mr. Tinker was booked on by the chairman of the budget committee in right after the March meeting.
Mrs. Wolseley, you are not the budget committee person. You asked to be relieved from it, and that's why you were.
I'm a member of this confounded board, and don't tell me Mr. Bean and Mr. Griffin told the assessing officer to not go.
Mrs. Wolseley, please don't speak for me. Please do not speak for me.
Mr. Bean spoke for you.
Mrs. Wolseley,
he said Mr. Griffin and I.
The budget committee.
That's irrelevant at this point in time.
No, it isn't. I'm sorry. If you wanted to be there, you could have been there.
Oh.
You asked not to. Please, let me have my say. If you want to talk again, you can have a follow-up.
The budget committee had its agenda set up, predicated on the assessing officer showing. The manager
Mrs.
has
Wolseley,
no
you are out of line.
Authority. I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. I am here to, I want to have my,
online.
You have made some accusations, and
yes,
I want to say.
Yes, I have.
Okay,
what
I think
did
you're
you
strongly
and Mr.
out of line.
Do? Against
Mrs.
the
Wolseley,
interests of this board.
Nobody did anything.
Yes,
just
you did.
Like, no, Mrs. Wolseley, please. You will have your chance to talk.
When?
After you let someone else have their chance to talk, please stop it.
You asked me a question.
Mrs. Wolseley, I'm not asking you a question. If you want to.
You're making misstatements.
May I make a comment?
No, well, in one moment. I mean,
okay.
No, Jim?
We agreed at this board to let things go through the representative, just like you were the representative the last time. As I want to address about the how we make in the past, whenever anybody want, you know, when there is an election, people are allowed to talk one-on-one. That's all that happened this year, just like every other year that I've been here. If you want to be the someone to nominate you, that was up to you to go ahead of time and make sure someone was going to nominate you. I can't imagine
we're
how you thought someone on this board would nominate you.
We're not supposed to be talking behind closed
doors.
One
on, no, there
people
are no closed doors. Mrs. Wolseley, you
election.
Will have your chance to talk.
Well, you
please,
came
Mrs.
Up
Wolseley,
to me
this
election.
Is my time to talk.
Well,
you're
I'll tell
out
you
of
what
line,
they said.
And then Mr. Waddell is going to talk next.
All
you
right.
will have your chance to talk, Mr. Waddell.
Yeah, I would just like to say that, you know, I was at a function the other night, and one of the restaurant owners in town was talking to me, and he's not concerned with who's chairman, and he's not concerned with if Mr. Bean said something at the budget committee. He's concerned about the sewer line going to his restaurant. People on Exeter Road are concerned about Exeter Road. Now, this board used to be, when I used to go to breakfast on Tuesday mornings, it used to be, did you see the foolishness that went on with the select board last night? People would be talking about it. Are we going to fall back into that? The fact that you were not elected chairperson, it was no conspiracy. It was none. Nobody came to me and said that I was going to make an issue out of it and vote for somebody. Nobody did that. It's been done before the tradition wasn't followed, and I think that we should just let that die out and go away, because the public is not interested in that. They're interested in getting the work of the town done. As the thing about representatives, we did talk on this board. We did have a discussion and said that because we talked about Rick on the planning board when he was there, that we wanted all of the correspondence to go through the representative of the planning board, of the different boards. The selectman's representative. So that was something that was discussed. That was not something that was done in the background. And I think we should get down to working on the business. I mean, this went on 2 years ago, removing people from the board, removing people from that. It was foolishness then. People laughed about it in town at that point. People laugh about it now. Let's get down to the business that's appropriate for the board. And let's deal with that and not deal with this foolishness.
Jim, let me...
Mrs. Woolsey, I will recognize you when it is your turn to talk.
Well,
it's my turn to talk now. Okay. It's went around, and I would like to say also that I feel that this is a tremendous waste of time. You spend a lot of time deciding who is going to need to be removed from the board, even though they may have gotten the most votes of anybody. You would like them to be removed. We need to respect what the voters are saying. And that's what I feel, too. I feel that I basically am not, as far as I'm concerned, I'm not involved in this at all. But I am involved because I am a member of this board. And, I mean, it's every time I come here, there's somebody, you're sneaking around trying to control things, control the board, or try to look at ways to offend the voting public. Because you don't agree with who they selected. I have a strong problem with that. Now it's your time to talk, Mrs. Woolsey.
Okay. Jim, I had the discussion while I was still the representative of this board in March with the chairman of the Budget Committee regarding having the assessing officer go in and talk to them this year, like he did last year, but on the reval. Because you have to admit that the relations with the Budget Committee were not good last year. And I said to all of you, I will volunteer to take on the position of Budget Committee representative this year to try to calm things down. And the chairman of the Budget Committee was very receptive to having Mr. Tinker go into the April meeting. She went in and talked to him. They sorted it out. He was all set. He was booked on. He was on their agenda, if I recall correctly. And at the last minute, to have a member of this board go into the manager, and the member of that board, being Mr. Bean, said he consulted with you, and the two of you determined that the manager should tell Mr. Tinker not to show up at that meeting, April 21st. That was set in, it was agreed to, the chairman of the Budget Committee talked to Mr. Tinker, he was all set to go, that was set up for the meeting. That has nothing to do with any decisions that anybody made funneling anything through anyone. That was predetermined. He was ready to go. The Budget Committee was ready to hear him. And Mr. Bean, spouting your name, and he did it again at the budget meeting, said that you two, and you're only two members of the board, told the manager to tell the assessing officer not to show up. That is outrageous. I say that is illegal. I say you have no right to do that as two members of this board.
I'm saying that it didn't happen.
Mr. Chairman, may I have the floor, please? Mr. Welch,
Mr. Bean.
May I please have you confirm that you did not tell the tax assessor that he was not going to attend the meeting?
That's correct.
Pardon me, I've got the floor, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Ms. Woolsey has asserted at least three times that you told the tax assessor not to go to the meeting. Is that incorrect?
I believe that's incorrect.
That is incorrect.
Yeah.
We're talking simply. May I a point of order?
Mrs. Woolsey, would you please stop interrupting.
Let other people talk.
Let other people have the floor. No one can talk when you're around. That's the problem here tonight. Mr. Bean.
Mr. Chairman, we're simply talking about formal lines of communication that enhances the types of issue that Selectman Waddell is talking about in execution of the most important company in town, the most important corporation. We have first responders. We have police, fire, public works. We have deteriorating infrastructure. We've got a budget committee that the 11th hour that went through the entire process. Cut $700,000 without notification to the Board of Selectmen, without notification. Department head members never consulted with any of them. And it's time to get in line with what the voters have done at the polls, and they have reduced that board. It's going to be a new input. And Mrs. Woolsey's assertions of,
You know, she and two other selectmen removed me from the chairperson spot. Those two people were voted off the island that voted with her. Elections will be held again. Ms. Woolsey, if she can't achieve success at the polls, wants to hire the town attorney, have us pay for it, and impose her royal dictatorship on the town. And it's just not consistent with reality. Her assertions about Mr. Welch tonight are not consistent with the truth. We have talked about this, as Selectman Waddell, as Selectman Bridle has told you. She talks about her ability as a former representative to the Budget Committee to impose her will on how I, working as your representative and the board's representative, is going to conduct my time. And that's simply fallacy. It's nonsense. Mrs. Woolsey condemned Mr. Moore several years ago when he left this board, forced off the board by her actions and two other selectmen. She said she didn't take her toys and go home. Well, she did that with the Budget Committee, and she quit. She quit one of the most important liaison committees in this town because the board didn't grant her a chairmanship. Now she's out to seek more legal effort. She wants to intimidate people. And if you're a department head in this town and you listen to this woman and you see how she treats elected officials, you have to wonder if you're the Esquire. You have to wonder if you're a department head. Who's next? And it's a climate of fear. It's a climate of pernicious, disputatious, pugnacious, egregious malice. And it will never end until she no longer sits at this board. Thank you, sir.
Mr. Waddell?
I made my statement that we're dealing with foolishness.
Well, and I just want to say that I have this. After the original time of when the first meeting of the Budget Committee, Mrs. Latimer, the chairman, called me up just one-on-one, and she instructed me that she did run into you going into Ed Tinker's office, and she strongly said to you that that's her job, not yours.
Yes.
And she led me to believe that before anything happened here at this board, that's why I thought you were unhappy. And when you agreed, you quit the board. That's why I thought you quit it, because you weren't getting your way there. And that's what she told me. She told me that you had a problem at the board not being in charge there. That's how she felt. She felt threatened by you also. I don't feel threatened by you, but in all 11 years I've been here, I've never had this problem with somebody going around trying to intimidate people, and I find it to be a problem. It's a problem for me. You have the floor.
Mrs. Latimer can make her own commentary. I'm not going to go.
Well, you talk about one-on-one.
But
conversation. And she called me, and that's what she told
me. That's fine. Then you can sort that out with her, and she can make her own public statement. I want to know why Mr. Tinker, who was scheduled and on the agenda for the April 21st Budget Committee meeting, I want to know why he did not show up, and that is not like Mr. Tinker. Number two, if you think the spectacle you made at that Budget Committee meeting on April 21st was going to bring good relations and productive relations with the Budget Committee, I beg to differ. Anybody who's seen that is appalled, and I think you have a hell of a nerve going behind our backs one-on-one telling the assessing officer what to do, you and Mr. Griffin. And you stated that. You stated that in public at the budget meeting, and you stated it in public.
Point of order, Mr. Chairman. There's no going behind backs here. It's professional leadership.
Not professional.
You can listen to Ms. Woolsey all night long.
You think your appearance was professional at the budget committee?
Mrs. Woolsey, are you suggesting that you want to be the budget committee rep? Maybe we can open that discussion when Mr. Bridle comes back.
I am saying that I will be delighted to represent the Budget Committee. I love working with the Budget Committee. But no, I am not going to talk to Budget Committee members with a bunch of selectmen sneaking around behind my back, forbidding the assessing officer to
go and meet with them. Don't shake your finger at me, please.
Well, you banged your gavel at me.
That's my job.
Oh,
thank you.
That's good to know. I work without
Okay. Any other comments? Mr. Waddell?
I've heard this song. It wasn't popular before. It shouldn't be popular again.
Thank you. Popular. Okay, we're going to be moving on to other new business. Does anyone have any new business? Mrs. Wolseley, are you going to participate?
God forbid, I should have new business.
Okay, so are you? Is it going to be this way? You really don't want to contribute. You don't want to be part of the board, evidently.
I want to be part of a board that cooperates and tells other members of the board what's happening, not two members of the board making a decision on their own.
That hasn't happened, Mrs. Wolseley.
As was publicly stated. Publicly stated. It's on the record.
Please stop shaking your finger at me. I find it offensive.
Oh, that's terrible.
And I really don't like your comments either.
Well, I didn't like hearing what I heard.
Okay, we're moving on to old business. Mrs. Wolseley, do you have any old business?
No, thank you.
Mr. Bean?
No, sir.
Mr. Waddell? And I don't either.
You have committee appointments under old business.
Okay. Yeah.
Where's this? Oh, there it is. Second page.
That cheat sheet that's on the third page.
Yeah. I will volunteer for the zoning board. Zoning Planning Commission.
Okay, so we're going to number one is Lease Land Real Estate Commission. We've already talked about that. And number two is committee appointments.
You have two committees that you have not resolved appointments on as of yet, Mr. Chairman. One is the Energy Committee. You do have recommendations from the committee for appointments. You have three people who have applied to serve on the committee, two as regular members, and one as an alternate. Mm-hmm. There is one position vacancy for a full member. Two people are vying for it, and the other one is a alternate position. There is one person requesting that position. And we'd like to know which way you'd like to go so that we could make the fills and do the paperwork and get that to you for signature.
Okay. So does someone want to?
Mr. DeRosier has recommended what, two individuals?
Mr. DeRosier has recommended Julia Martinelli, mm-hmm. Who is a relatively new resident in town who has come in and volunteered and talked to Mr. DeRosier. And he has recommended to reappoint Mr. Tom Monaghan as the alternate member. I can't get that out
he's
of my...
He's been on the board before. He's been one of the founding members of the
That's
board.
That's right. He'd like to go back on as an alternate.
It's Tom Monaghan, and I will move that we appoint both at Mr. DeRosier's request.
I will second that.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
And we did have a letter from the town planner, I believe, because the zoning board is setting up a zoning
yes, ma'am, you're correct.
Committee like yep. the planning board review committee, and I would be happy to volunteer to work with the zoning board on that planning committee.
Now,
it's up to you folks, not me.
Yeah, maybe...
I would recommend we wait until Mr. Bridle returns.
That's what I was going to suggest.
They need an answer by May 5th.
I think that we'll wait till we will wait till Mr. Bridle is here.
Well, that's very nice.
Okay, Mrs. Wolseley.
Meeting is the 4th. Your next meeting is the 4th, ma'am.
Oh, good. And the 5th is the following night.
Right.
Good.
The other committee, Mr. Chairman, that you have to make a decision on is the Recycling Education Committee, or Education Recycling Committee, depending on who's talking about it. I guess they've used the terms interchangeably. Mm-hmm. You have had all of the current members all of the members' terms have expired, and they've all requested to be reappointed.
I thought we were going to discuss the merits of the committee.
Well, and that's certainly something that's the purview of the Board of Selectmen as to whether or not you would like to even have the committee. Mm-hmm. This is certainly the opportunity to do that. If you do not, then you certainly should not do reappointments. On the other hand, if you think you should have the committee, then we need to fill the vacancies.
Why table that until Mr. Russ, until Mr. Yes. Bridle comes back.
Excellent. That's what I would suggest also. Any other old business? Mr. Waddell?
No.
Mrs. Wolseley?
No.
No, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Well, I'd like to bring something up. To be truthful, Mrs. Wolseley, we've had many complaints about you keep talking. Every time you make these comments, and I find it very distracting. I've already talked to you in private about it, but that doesn't matter. But we're trying to make sure this board works in a certain way, and from now on, I would appreciate it if you would not comment until it's your turn to comment. Thank you. Closing comment, are we What about the return to the, do we have to go to that?
Mr. Chairman, I would recommend that we not reopen that tonight, that we continue to postpone that until your next meeting.
And we're waiting to meet with, tonight, with Mr. Gerald, so does someone want to make that?
This is regarding Stowcroft Road and the...
Do you want to meet with us tonight?
That's all right. I think next week's best.
Next week is best, okay. Closing comments?
Closing comments, yeah. I don't want to beat a dead horse, but I just want to say that I respect Selectman Woolsey. I respect her opinion. I think she has a lot to offer to this board. I think we got off to a bad start. I would like to see us work through this problem and come to a consensus where we're working cooperatively together. People did not go behind her back. She has a difference of opinion on what happened. But I think we have a year to go here together. I think we can work through this. I think we can work cooperatively. I think we respected each other last year. I respect her opinion. You have a history in Hampton. You know what's going on. And I, just from my point of view, totally, I would like to see us move forward and not move backwards.
I also would like to see us move forward. And I respect the voters. The voters voted for Mrs. Woolsey. That's why she's here. And we need to try to work together. And I'm all for it. Mrs. Woolsey.
I would just like to ask you one question, Mr. Waddell, and I appreciate your remarks. Did you know that Mr. Bean was saying that he and Mr. Griffin took that action? Were you consulted?
I was not consulted, no.
Thank you.
I
appreciate
it. It's not to say that anyone took any action.
Yeah,
no, this was in the name of the board, and I just wanted to
That was a...
My closing comments, yeah. Mr. Chairman, would be that she didn't hear a word you said, Jim.
Yeah.
Motion to adjourn.
I'm sorry.
Thank you.
What time?
I second.
9:55.
Thank you.
You're
right. Need a vote.
You're right.
I'm voting.
Aye.